Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. The first item on the agenda is, is consideration of whether to take items 8 and 9 in private. 8 and 9 are to consider the evidence we will hear today under items 4 and 5. Are we agreed to take these items in private? We are agreed. The second item of the on the agenda is the consideration of a draft statutory instrument, the Transport Scotland Act 2019 Amendment Regulations 2023. I'm pleased to welcome Fiona Hislop, the Minister for Transport. I'd also like to welcome Bridget Bryden, the Bus Regulatory Policy Team Leader for Transport Scotland, and Kevin Gibson, the solicitor for the Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means it cannot come into force unless the Parliament approves it. Following the evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to recommend the approval of the instrument. And I just remind everyone that you can, and the officials can, speak under this item, but not under the next item. I therefore would like to ask the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning, Convener and Committee. The Transport Scotland Act 2019 was designed to help make Scotland's transport network cleaner, smarter and more accessible than ever before. During the parliamentary passage of the bill, which became the Transport Scotland Act 2019, a significant number of amendments were made at stages 2 and 3. For context, the convener may recall that the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee considered more than 400 amendments at stage 2, with the consideration of amendments at stage 3 lasting around 7 hours. This included amendments to provisions which themselves amended existing primary legislation and the introduction of new provisions to which cross-references were made. As a consequence, the bill as passed contained a significant number of provisions which required to be renumbered and cross-references which had to be corrected before its publication. When this exercise was undertaken, a substantial number of cross-references and other numbering errors were corrected within a short timescale prior to publication of the Act. However, in a small number of cases, cross-references were unfortunately not updated. The primary purpose of these regulations is therefore to correct these erroneous cross-references and incorrect numbering in the provisions on bus services and smart ticketing in the Act. The regulations also remove duplicate provision to the parliamentary procedure attaching to regulations under the Act. We are also using this opportunity to correct one minor drafting error in section 55 of the Act on parking prohibitions, which ensures that the effect of that provision is clear. These regulations make relatively minor technical amendments to the Act, which will ensure that full effect is given to the intention of Parliament in passing the Act. I'm happy to answer any questions that members may have.
Thank you, Minister. And I do indeed remember the bill as it went through stage 1 and stage 2 in the committee that I was convener of at that stage, and probably all the amendments. I don't think I've ever seen quite so many amendments at different stages. So thank you for coming back. I think Monica has a question she'd like to ask you on this. Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and her officials. Yes, thank you, Minister, for clarifying the minor and technical nature. But I just wondered if you can clarify for the committee when these errors first came to the government's attention and whether the nature of these errors, I think you talked about some incorrect numbering and erroneous cross-referencing, could that have led to anyone inadvertently not complying with the law?
Answered by officials if they have that information, because obviously, as you'll know, I wasn't the minister at the time that this was happening, but I'm happy to take up the responsibility to tidy up the legislation in a technical way. Kevin, would you want to come around that?
Of course, yeah. So the errors have been identified over a period of time, from some quite early, some not too long after the Act was published, and right up until fairly recently. So it's been a sort of process, I think. On the specific point about whether anybody may have inadvertently failed to comply with the law due to these errors? The answer is no. The provisions in question are not in force yet, so they're being brought into force over the next few months. So we're tidying up these errors before the law becomes effective.
Well, that's reassuring to hear that those parts are not enforced. And just for the record, because not everyone in the committee would have been involved in the legislation, that's quite a long period of time, I think. So so when was the first date, Mr Gibson, that this came to government's attention?
Maybe I could answer that. The Transport Act, because I asked a sort of similar question as to, obviously, there's many provisions and we have to make sure that obviously the Transport Act can be enacted, and there's a very important provisions within that. It came into legislation around the end of 2019, and it wasn't that long after we were obviously heading into the pandemic, and at that time right across government people were diverted from legislation and other policy work into managing the pandemic. So there the whole provisions and include the corrections were something that obviously have been delayed understandably at the time, but clearly what's happening now is we've got a number of the provisions in process already laid that will help take forward the powers within the Transport Act.
Thank you. No further questions from me, convener.
Thank you, Monica, and good point. Well cleared up. I think that was useful to hear that. Are there any other questions from the committee? I'm not seeing any, so we'll move straight on to the next item on the agenda, which is the formal consideration of motion S6M10469, calling on the committee to recommend approval of the Transport Scotland Act 2019 Amendment Regulations 2023. Minister, do you want to speak to the motion, or are you happy that you've spoken enough?
If you're happy to, I'm just happy to move the motion.
I'm happy you've spoken enough, Minister. Thank you on that. So are there any members who want to make a contribution to this? No. So, Minister, are you happy to forgo your summing up, or would you like to sum up?
I'm happy to forgo.
Thank you. So the question is then for the committee, is motion S6M10469 in the name of Fiona Hislop be approved? Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The committee will therefore report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I would like to ask the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to finalise the report for publication. Are we all happy with that? Yep, good. Thank you, Minister, and thank you to your officials for coming along today. And I'm now briefly going to suspend the meeting before our next item. Thank you. Welcome back. Our next item of business is an evidence session with two of Scotland's statutory environmental regulators, Nature Scot and the Scottish Environmental Protection Agency. The committee aims to have these sessions each year with the environmental regulators where we can discuss their annual reports, finances and main priorities for the year ahead. This will be a wide-ranging session with touching on many aspects of all their roles. It may also contribute to the committee's pre-budget recommendations to the Scottish Government in the coming weeks and our work in other areas in future months. I'm pleased to welcome Nick Harford, the Director of Nature and Climate Change for Nature Scot, and David Harley, the Chief Officer for the Circular Economy, Scottish Environmental Protection Agency. Thank you for joining us today. And I believe you each want to make brief opening statements, and I'm told it's going to Nick first and then to David. So, Nick.
Yes, and good morning. Thank you very much for inviting me today. So, just a couple of quick comments. As you know, Nature Scot is Scotland's public nature agency. We bring 30 years of experience, expertise and passion to our nation's most vital endeavour, tackling the nature and climate crisis. Just as a reminder of the scale of the crisis, the State of Nature report stated last week that in Scotland, 1 in 9 of our species is threatened with national extinction, and that since 1994, there's been a 15% decline in average species abundance across our closely monitored wildlife. In response to this crisis, we're seeing a significant amount of policy development in the Scottish Government and a number of bills this session in the Parliament. From Nature Scot's perspective, this policy development, building what has already gone before, is a major opportunity to reverse nature decline and hit net zero targets. And we're energised by the direction of travel. We know that it will increase demand on our services and advice, and there will no doubt be, this will no doubt be true for a range of other public bodies, including local authorities. We think we can rise to this increased expectation on us, but it does put pressure on our capacity and resource. In response, as well as driving efficiency, we're getting creative. This means we're changing our approaches to delivery, especially in the digital solutions. We're identifying new appropriate revenue streams, and we're fully engaged in public sector reform. And we recognise the value of the Scottish Government's commitment to invest £500 million in nature through to 2026. This is very welcome and necessary. We're also seeing increased interest in nature finance from private sources, with our role being to promote responsible investment in natural capital. As promising as all of this wider investment is, much of our support for the transformation we need to see comes from our core resource funded by grant and aid from Scottish Government, topped up by ring-fenced funds for things like nature restoration and peatland action. And whilst the ring-fenced funds continue to increase, our core grant and aid is under considerable pressure, both from challenging public finances and high inflation. To close on a positive note, the public sector is rising to the nature climate challenge, where before it might have been the sole purview of organisations such as my own, Nature Scot. We now see everyone stepping up, and this will be a cornerstone of a whole society response to the crisis. Thank you.
Thanks, Nick. David.
Thank you, convener, and good to be here today. This is CEPA's 27th year as Scotland's environmental regulator. We cover a huge range of functions and regulatory duties, covering all aspects of Scotland's environment, including water, resources and air. We work with operators and we work with people across all sorts of scales, from the very local to like a septic tank level, right up to national infrastructure such as Grangemouth Oil Refinery and everything in between. We're protecting and improving the environment, and that protection job is something which is worth thinking about in the context of ongoing development over the last 30 years and with the impacts of climate change. Our staff are daily responding to events, permitting activities, auditing, inspecting, monitoring, and so on. Another key role for us is our role as Scotland's flood authority, where we're involved in flood warning, advising planning authorities in new development, and in national strategic flood risk planning. As Nick said there, the climate emergency and biodiversity crisis presents an extraordinary challenge and an opportunity for environmental regulators. There's increased expectation from the public, and that's quite right, and there's increased there's more for us to do across a very wide front. As we work on our new corporate plan for the next 3 years up to 2027, that need to focus is to the fore. We need to be able to make an impact in the most efficient and effective way possible. That focus is in our emerging corporate plan is going to be on climate resilience, net zero, the water environment, resource use, and always underpinned by compliance across the board. Speak a little bit about finances. Our finances are 50% grant and aid and roughly 50% the charges that we take in from those that we regulate. We're also using, we had a cyber attack in 2020. We're using that as an opportunity to modernise the organisation, particularly in relation to digital services. We're working on our annual report. And our Chief Executive and Chief Financial Officer will be very pleased to come and talk to you about the financial report for 2022-23 in the new year.
Thank you very much. Before we go any further, I just want to remind the committee of my declaration of interest in that I am part of a family farming partnership on Speyside. As such, we have regular interaction with Nature Scott and with SEPA. SEPA also happened to be a tenant of a small part of my farm, where they have a gauging station and a monitoring station to monitor water quality, which I encourage them to do. So I do have regular interactions with both agencies. My first question then, or the first question from me, is since the last meeting, David, there's been a change in the leadership of SEPA. It was quite abrupt, and there has been a small period of time while there has been no... Well, I'm sure there's been effective leadership, but there's been no designated chief executive. Do you want to just say whether that will result in wider changes of governance and culture within your organisation, or were those sufficient when that change came about?
So the first thing that we did upon the departure of the previous chief executive was have a listening exercise with our staff to learn lessons that might have been learned from the culture around that leadership. 10% of staff participated in that, and we have a series of recommendations which we are embedding into the way we manage ourselves going forward. We're very much on that. We've very much moved on. Joe Green did a fantastic job as an interim chief executive for a period of 10 months. Nicole Patterson joined us, I think it was in November last year, and we're very much moving on and looking forward. Nicole has made some adjustments about in how we work, but those are largely administrative, very much a big focus on delivery, getting on and getting the job done. Very much about empowering our staff and devolving decision-making into the organisation, which is the way it should be. So we've moved on.
Thank you. And I met your chief executive, and one of the issues that I constantly hear about is issues relating to the cyber attack, and that you're still running to try and get back to where you were before. Is that the case, or do you think you're fully caught up now?
We're not fully caught up. The cyber attack was devastating. It stopped us in our tracks. And for 3 months, most of our staff couldn't communicate with each other. It was that devastating. We lost a lot of data was taken from us, and our most of our systems were completely destroyed. I can talk a little bit more about the phases that we're going through in terms of that. I would say we're focusing now on building bespoke systems. So we've built. We've got our organisation up and running from a technical point of view, from an IS point of view. We've created the infrastructure the sort of the IS infrastructure for a much more modern organisation. And what we're working on now is those bespoke systems associated with things like licence administration, laboratory data handling, planning, casework. So at the moment, some of those systems, we have workaround systems that enable us to do those functions at the moment. They're a little clunky. They're not as efficient as they could be, but we're working on getting those systems in place.
I think the committee would seek reassurance that though your resilience to such attacks in the future has been greatly enhanced, and that you have a reserve system in place to ensure that it doesn't destroy, if it did happen again, exactly where you were when it did happen, when no one could speak to each other. So I'd like some confirmation on that.
Yeah, absolutely. There was 3 independent assessments done of our condition or of our status, and we're working on all the recommendations. We've delivered all the recommendations in terms of security and resilience going forward. So I'm very confident in that now.
And how much is the new system going to cost, computer-wise?
I don't have the exact cost. We're getting help from the Scottish Government, 3-year capital budget, and we're moving into our 3rd year on that. I don't have the exact costs, but I can...
Would it be possible to write to the committee and say what the new system is costing?
Absolutely.
So that we're aware, and if possible, we can then follow it through into the Scottish budget. OK, thank you for that. The next questions on this come from... Sorry, Mark, did you raise your hand? I wasn't sure. No. OK, sorry. The next questions come from Douglas Lumsden. Douglas.
Yeah, thanks, Commissioner. I'm just going to stick on the budget lines just now. So when we look at the year-on-year funding over the last 8 years, there has been a decline until this year's budget, when there was an increased funding from the Scottish Government. So what sort of impact has that had on your organisations and the work you're trying to do?
I think that's directed. Both.
Yep.
Okay, so Nick, David just had a bit of a session there, so why don't you start off on that one?
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, just to be clear, the additional money that we had in the year we're in at the moment was because the Scottish Government brought forward monies that we would usually get in the autumn budget change, that they were given at the start of the year. What we see overall is that our grant and aid has pretty much remained static over the last 4 years once you strip those things out. What it means, obviously at crude level, is that we have less money to spend on services once you take account of inflation and increased costs of staff. So what we're having to do is prioritise very hard and innovate where we can around service delivery. So we're looking, for example, at the moment about how we can move our licensing online, because we think that will be a far more efficient way and we can drive efficiencies through that. But it does mean we have to prioritise around the key priorities that the government set for and that we've agreed with through a corporate plan for 22-26.
Because it almost seems a bit strange to me. You spoke about policy development, the government trying to hit net zero targets and increase in demand, but at the same time, your core funding has been reduced, so it doesn't quite make sense to me that...
Well, what we've seen overall, our overall budget has increased.
Right, okay.
Because there have been ring-fence monies, I mentioned Nature Restoration Fund, Better Places Fund, the Peatland Action Fund, and they come with the resources to deliver those. But what we have is our core grant and aid, which is paying for everything else, for example, our ongoing monitoring of nature sites, our ongoing gathering of data. That has stayed level and therefore in real terms decreased. And that is very challenging. So, for example, for monitoring, we have to look more at, can we get citizens to do the monitoring on our behalf? And in some instances, that's very successful, but there is still a core amount of activity that we have to sustain.
Mm-hmm. And David, I think your sort of core budget is quite similar to Nature Scott, where it is, in real terms, reducing. Is that correct?
In real terms, it has reduced. It has stayed broadly the same. And I'd remind the committee that, it's 50% of our operating costs. The other 50% we have some control over. We must cost recover. But we set charges for those that we regulate in terms of permitting charges and subsistence charges. So we do have some control over that. At the moment, grant and aid stands at 49% of our total budget. A similar response to Nick. We need to prioritise and be much more ruthless about that prioritisation, and we need to work with government on that. There's a lot of expectation coming from government as well, so we need to really focus on where we make the greatest impact.
So are you able to make up that shortfall from licensing, for example, or, you know, chargeable things?
We've just conducted a review of our charging scheme with that in mind. We can only recover the costs that we have in relation to those particular roles. Marginally, we can make some tweaks and we can get a little bit extra in on that. But broadly, it doesn't make a huge difference in the big scheme of things.
Mm-hmm. And Nick, obviously Nature Scotland have been trying to move to a full recovery model in terms of licensing. Can you give us a bit of an update there? And have you been talking to SEPA, for example, and how they do it, and see if there's anything to learn there?
Yes, I mean, SEPA is one of the organisations we clearly look to because they have experience in this area. It's not exactly the same because a lot of the licences we deal with are for, they're not for businesses, they might be for individuals who do bird ringing, for example. So we're looking to trial our cost recovery on those areas where we're dealing with businesses who we think can afford them or won't be adversely affected by paying them without putting a burden on individuals who are often we need to licence, but they're doing activities almost on a voluntary basis. So, but absolutely, we're learning from SEPA because there's a model in there I think can be useful. There's a question about that will hopefully cover the costs, the additional costs of the additional licences that we're about to take on through the Muirburn legislation. But I'm not sure it's going to be a good cost recovery model for a whole load of the other licences that we already deal with.
Mm. Over the summer, I've been talking to wind farm developers, for example, and there may be changes to the planning process to try and make that, just try and speed up that process. But one of the complaints I do get is organisations, it probably because lack of resource, it takes quite a while for those organisations to give a approval or to make sort of comments on the application. So do you see that as a problem, or due to lack of resource, or is it something that could be changed by maybe changing the way the licensing works or the fees work? Or
yes, so when we deal with planning applications, we don't charge for those; they're not chargeable from us. Mm-hmm. So that's different from licensing. So we will be commenting to the decision maker or giving advice, and that is quite difficult to predict the volume that's coming through. We don't control the volume and it varies hugely. So we try and be as flexible as we can to make sure that we have the staff available when we have a surge of applications. We've been quite effective in saying we're only going to look at the most impactful applications, whether they be onshore or offshore. What we are really challenged by, though, which is a kind of nice challenge to have in a way, is the increased volume of applications, particularly from wind farms, particularly offshore, where it is very, it's kind of new territory, and the amount of data and the quality of that data and the specificity of applications can be really challenging. But we're as efficient as we possibly can be because we want, particularly wind farms and other renewables, we want them to happen if at all possible, but we have to make sure that in doing so, particularly offshore, we are not driving the one industry's success but at a huge cost to nature and biodiversity, and it's getting that balance right that can take quite a bit of time.
But is that anything that developers could actually pay more into to try and increase your capacity so that could be maybe done quicker? Or
potentially, if that were paid into a central pot to all of those advisers, mm-hmm. what we would find very difficult to just do that unilaterally, because to do it unilaterally would appear to be favouring one applicant over another, which we wouldn't do. But there's theoretically, yes, there could be a greater contribution to give greater resources and improved data. But having said that, some of this stuff is just really difficult. I mean, mm-hmm. if we're dealing with seabirds, for example, we may need 2 years' data to understand what's happening. One isn't enough. 2 years to see that we can compare. So some of these things just do take time to get right.
Yeah, and I wasn't trying to single yourselves out. You know, I hear the same about Crown Estates and Marine Scot as well, that it does take a lot of time for these organisations to actually give a view on new developments. David, I think you wanted to come in.
Yeah, if I can. It was just to say that one area where I think we can be more efficient in the widest sense is that pre-application discussion is really important with any developer. And that can be, and potentially with other regulators, and doing that early on, and that requires the developer to be ready as well. That can result in big benefits then when it comes to the formal application process. And that's something that we're trialling with aquaculture, with the relevant local authority and Nature Scot. We're looking at a way of doing a parallel, sort of a streamlined parallel process there, which should result in efficiencies.
Okay. Sorry.
You go on to your next lot of questions. There are some other questions that members want on budget. Is now the right time to bring
yes.
them in? Okay. Ben, I think you wanted to come in. Sorry, our Deputy Convener, Ben.
Thank you, Convener. I was also going to ask about the consenting process, and I think your answers there in response to Mr. Lumsden were really helpful and gives us some food for thought in terms of also inquiring with other organisations. Also on organisational priorities and therefore budgets, I just had one other question for SEPA. I noted that in your submission, in the priorities, you list the response to waste crime as a priority. And I just wondered if you wanted to emphasise any parts of that as a priority in terms of the challenge of dealing with the influence of both organised and small operational criminals within the sector and the challenge that presents to all of us.
I can absolutely share your concern in terms of the environmental impact, but also in terms of the fair play across all the legitimate operators in that sector. We put a lot of effort into this. About 10 years ago, we set up a dedicated enforcement and investigation unit that was that really lifted our game in terms of investigations using intelligence, working with the police. And as you'll appreciate, there's a lot of criminality involved in that sector as well. So it's a very specific type of regulation and enforcement that we need there. It's a specific type of skills. I can go on at some length about the different types of investigations that we've got ongoing over the last years.
I don't want to preempt this, but I think you're going to get a chance to do that in the next session when we look at that actual within that part of the bill. Sorry, Ben.
No, I'm happy to wait till later. And if there's any follow-up thereafter that might be helpful for the committee, we'd appreciate that as appropriate. I know it's a sensitive area. Thank you.
Okay. Just before we move from this, Nick, if I understand this rightly, you've got the hunting with dogs licensing scheme just landed on your... Well, it's landed on your plate before, but it becomes effective. I think it's today, isn't it? And you're about to get the grouse moor licensing scheme. Last time I visited Nature Scot or SNH, there was... I think it was Donald Fraser, if I remember rightly, was your licensing officer in a very, very small team. And he said he could do everything. Does he need more resources and with this extra legislation? And are you in a position to give it to them?
You're right. We are. It was Donald Fraser. And our licensing functions are expanding rapidly. Obviously, we have the hunting with dogs, which is quite contentious but relatively modest. In terms of the number of applications we expect to receive. But having said that, we do expect it to be contentious. So although our licensing function to deal with that, I'm sure, can be done in-house within our existing team, if we get taken to legal challenge on any of our decisions, that is hugely resource-intensive, but we're anticipating that. Far more significant in terms of resources will be the licensing envisaged around grouse moors and Muirburn. And as you'll know from the financial memorandum that were published with that bill, we're looking at start-up costs, I think, about £400,000 or £450,000, and then ongoing running costs of about £350,000. They're detailed in the financial memorandum. We are looking at how we're going to fund that. We would wish to get that through some sort of cost recovery in due course, but that won't be immediate. So that is part of our ongoing discussions with Scottish Government about funding what are additional responsibilities. And clearly we're looking also beyond that legislation to the other bits of legislation that are likely to be in the Parliament, particularly around the Natural Environment Bill. So we'll be working hard on the financial memorandum to make sure that it's clear what the additional costs to us will be and discussions around how we're going to fund that.
Sorry, I just picked up on one word. You said legal challenge, which you are ready for. Does that mean you're anticipating it?
With all our functions, we will be looking at the risk of legal challenge. And this is a very new area. And our intelligence is that it's not unlikely. Gosh, that sounds weasel wordy. It might well happen that we get legal challenge around this, given the nature of the function and the applicant's appetite.
So that could take a considerable time and a considerable resource to things. So I'm just trying to work out in my mind if there's enough people in that department to do what you're being asked to do. It sounds by what you're saying there ain't, and you need more money.
There aren't at the moment, but we're anticipating having those discussions about how we're going to cope with these additional responsibilities as a result of legislation.
Well, that's interesting, because I think when we discussed it as a parliament, we were told there was no additional resource required. Anyway, we'll leave it there. And Douglas, I think the next question from you.
Can you convene on?
Hold on. Oh. Sorry, Mark, you wanted to come in. Was that on this side?
Yes.
Sorry, go for it.
Thanks, convener. You just sort of piqued my interest. You're talking about the licensing of hunting. I just wanted to get a view from Nature Scott. I mean, do you think that there isn't a circumstance whereby a mounted hunt could credibly claim to be meeting the criteria for licences to be issued?
This isn't my area of expertise, but I understand from colleagues that the bar is set incredibly high. So it's not a general licence idea where everyone will get one who applies unless they do something terrible. It's more the other way around, where there's an incredibly high bar to be met for these licences to be issued. And because there's a high bar, that is why we are thinking that there may well be legal challenge, particularly as it's quite new.
OK. All right, that's useful then.
Convener, could I just come back on something you said previously?
Yeah.
The financial memorandum, which I looked at again this morning, does make clear the additional costs to our organisation, indeed other organisations, from the Muirburn and Grousemuir licensing. So it is in the public domain.
I accept that. I was talking about the hunting with dogs one, which I'm not aware there was any additional funds made available. But if I'm wrong, I will obviously correct the record. Douglas, back to you with your next question.
Yes, thank you, convener. Moving on to peatland restoration. So 3 years ago, the Scottish Government committed to spending £250 million over a 10-year period. How much of that's actually been spent to date? Are you able to give us that figure?
I don't have that figure in front of me, but I'm happy to supply it subsequently. What I would say, comment on that, is that this is a new industry, and what's been challenging us isn't the availability of money. What's been challenging us is the availability, particularly of contractors, to undertake peatland restoration work, and the willingness of many land managers to come forward, because they have said, well, if we do this peatland restoration, how would it relate to agricultural support mechanisms? How does it relate to the carbon market? So there's been a great deal of really understandable reticence, I think, in a number of landowners to come forward with big applications until some of those other areas have been sorted out. And we've been working really hard with the contracting sector to get increased volume and to help them in what is a very seasonal piece of work, how we can help them develop the peatland restoration alongside other activities and get the skills and the machinery, because it's a very skillful job.
Mm-hmm. So do you expect the spend to ramp up then over that 10-year period?
Absolutely. As with any industry that is new, we're in those kind of early foothills, but we are absolutely expecting it to increase. The feedback we have from contractors is they're kind of get this and they're tooling up for this. The feedback we get from land managers is that more and more of them are willing to come forward as it becomes clearer how this does relate, although it's still not 100% clear yet, with other elements of policy, and also how it can be a source of income to them through carbon credits.
So it still sounds like there's a lot of work to be done then before it would ramp up.
It is taking time, but we are beginning to see it ramp up. But it will take a number of years. It's a bit like the North Sea oil and gas industry in its early days. We're finding our way through that.
OK. And in terms of, obviously, there was £20 million committed back in 2020-21. And if that wasn't spent, I presume that doesn't come to you as much as you would like it to. That would probably just drift back into the government's own coffers for them to spend on anything they like.
To date, the peatland restoration money has been ring-fenced. So if we haven't spent it and we'll declare it back to government that we're not on course to spend it, we return it to Scottish Government.
So you can't spend it on anything
Not to
else.
Date.
Right. OK. Thanks, Scheme Interesting.
Thank you. Thank you, Douglas, for those. The next questions, I think, come from Mark. Mark Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I wanted just to come back then to natural capital finance. There's obviously quite a debate at the moment around how the regulation of these markets can be done in a way that, you know, builds in the right values and that the markets, you know, have some integrity behind them as well. I was interested in your thoughts on that and specifically on the finance pilot at the moment and the MOU that's been signed around that. I mean, the headline, I think, is £2 billion worth of funding. If you could just tell us how much of that, well, is there additional public finance that will come in on the back of that £2 billion, what the kind of mix is of private and public? But, yeah, your general thoughts on natural capital finance would be useful as well.
OK, I'll kick off on that, if I may. I think a couple of general points to start with. The size of the funding gap, if we are to halt the loss of biodiversity and restore nature, not just for its own sake, but principally as a way of adapting to the far more chaotic climate we have, is estimated to be around £20 billion. Could be higher, could be lower, but it's in that order. So our thinking initially is that is way beyond public finance, however optimistic we are about growing the economy. So this is why we have been looking for a number of years at bringing in more private finance into the sector. And so the example that you talked about there, where we're working with Hamdens and a number of other individuals, is just one area in which we're seeking to explore. It's like a pilot area, where we're looking to explore where we can get private finance in, blended with public finance and land management businesses, to see if there is a model that will give a return both to the private interests but also to the public objectives that we're trying to achieve. We're also looking at a number of other routes to we might achieve that. So that's where the ambition is, and driven, as I said, by the fact that there is a huge amount of work to be done, and at the moment we see no other route other than engaging responsibly, and it is absolutely responsibly, and there's a framework that we know colleagues in Scottish Government are working on so that we can do that responsibly.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so sorry, can you just go back to my question at the end there then around how much public finance will come in, and if you could just explain a bit more about the model. So how will it be monitored? What do you see as the opportunities and risks with the model? What stage of development is that pilot with Hamdens?
It's still at a fairly early stage, and elements of it are commercially sensitive at the moment because we are still in discussions. We are talking to private businesses. But I would say it's maybe at a too early a stage to be specific about the element of public finance and private finance. But what we're absolutely clear is that, come to your monitoring point, it will need to be very closely monitored, because we want to make sure that we're getting the public benefits from the public sector investment, and equally the private investors will want to be able to show that they are gaining the kind of the credits, as it were, the almost the biodiversity credits or climate change credits that they're wanting from what is an incredibly early and emerging market. So I'm happy to give more details in letter if you like, but I'm not sure I can offer much more at the moment, given the stage at which those negotiations are up.
Sure. I mean, it's clearly an area of interest for this committee. So, you know, as details emerge, I'm sure we'd like to have a look at that and you know, see exactly how projects are emerging on the ground, but it may be too early to see that at this point. Back to you, Convener.
Thanks very much. Just before we leave this, Nick, can I just push a little bit? I want to understand where that 20... I mean, don't get me wrong, I don't think there's enough money in the public sector to fund all the things that need to be done, but I don't understand where that £20 billion figure comes from, and I don't understand the methodology of receiving it. If you're not, if you're happier to write, I'm happy to receive that in writing.
Yeah, no, I will write, but I also just say it's a midpoint estimate. This is not an exact science, and there have been various different studies that have tried to estimate it. So £20 billion is the headline midpoint figure. And it isn't exact, but it is, I think, a scale. But I'm happy to provide the kind of the provenance, as it were, of those estimates.
I know where it came from. I'm just not sure I understand how they got there. So I'm anything to stop it being a guesstimate would be helpful. The other question I've got is that if £2 billion comes from the private sector to invest, they will be obviously selling on or trading the carbon credits for that. So I want to know, I'd be helpful for me to understand, if it's a joint public-private partnership, is should the carbon credits be jeopardised because the terms of the agreement for locking up those carbon credits and remedial work needs to come forward and be done to protect them, who carries the risk? The person who sold them, or the person who invested them and oversaw the scheme? Or is there a joint risk, and what risk is there to the public purse from this? Because it slightly concerns me that, you know, once the money's been paid, it's probably 80 years those carbon credits will be traded for. And I want to know who's going to be carrying the can in 60 years' time if there's any infringement. Is that nature, Scott?
I'll have to come back to you on that.
Okay. Perfect. I'll leave it there. It's quite a niche subject, as Mark says, but an interesting one. The next question comes from Monica Lennon. Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. My questions are, I think, all for David Hartley of SEPA. First of all, want to pick up on enforcement. Because there has been some recent criticism played out in the media and by some environmental groups and communities, there's been a decreasing trend in enforcement action. So I wonder, Mr. Hartley, if you can respond to some of those concerns and explain to the committee whether you believe there's a right balance within SEPA between supporting business and communities and enforcing compliance with environmental regulations.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, aware of those concerns. I think it's quite a reductive way to look at SEPA's report performance to look firmly at prosecutions and the number of those. It's really about the impact and working with those operators and pulling levers further upstream in the process to ensure that we don't get those non-compliant activities in the first place. And that's where that can be more effective in the long run in terms of environmental outcome. That said, we have plenty of prosecutions and lots of enforcement work underway, and a lot of that isn't visible until it actually happens. It's still very much our ethos that we wield a big stick when needed. But at the same time, I think we need to be strategic about that and pull all the levers we can to ensure that we don't get that non-compliance in the first place.
Thank you, Mr. Hartley. And I think many would agree that it's the prevention of that non-compliance that's really critical work. I have to say, those who've been quite vocal, I would say, are friends of SEPA, including two former chief executives who have express, I think, sympathy. They've made comments, including SEPA's been starved of funding. You know, we've heard there's been your funding's been splashed by more than a quarter in real terms since 2010. So starved of funding, said one former CEO, and another said distracted by cost-saving exercises, which takes officers away from the front line of environmental regulation. So it sounds like these people are critical friends. Are they saying the things out loud that people within CEPA today would perhaps like to say to committees like ours?
I don't think so. I mean, we both talk about the challenging times that we're in and the need to focus. And that's really important, that prioritisation of activities towards the greatest impact. Because as the public, quite rightly, get more concerned about environmental issues, they can pull us here and there, or pull us from, they can distract us from some of the work that can be truly impactful. It's interesting that expression about cost-saving exercises. I don't see a situation where our frontline staff are actually distracted on working on cost-saving exercises. I do think we can be more efficient, and we're building our systems to enable us to do so. And I do think we need to prioritise further.
Okay, so in terms of the original question about striking that right balance between supporting and enforcing compliance by businesses, you think right now the balance is good?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Okay, well, maybe slightly moving away from enforcement, I wanted to ask about your information and what's available in the public domain. I think this was touched on slightly, I think, by the convener when he asked about your recovery from the cyber attack. And I think you said, Mr. Hanley, that not all your systems are fully back up and running and not all your data is fully available. Now, this has caused a lot of concern. I think it's the Environmental Rights Centre of Scotland have made an official complaint to Environmental Standards Scotland about CEPA. So I'm not sure the status of that right now. This was based on media reports from a couple of weeks ago. But they're very concerned that CEPA is failing to maintain the public register. And that means that pollution permits for around 175,000 sites are not available. It's not in the public domain. So what's going on there?
Yeah, we're as a evidence-based regulatory organisation, it's in our DNA to be transparent and accountable. It pains us greatly that we don't have that information publicly available. We do actually have a public register, but it's in boxes and in paper format, and it's not easily accessible. And that's where the main problem is. So it was absolutely significantly impacted by both in terms of the data that's available electronically, but also the... sorry, I've lost my track there. The data is unavailable electronically, but also the ability for us to interrogate and for the public to interrogate that data is significantly compromised. We're rebuilding our public register in phases with a short-term focus on making more information publicly available. The other thing that we're working on is that it'll be much, much more accessible. The other area that we're really struggling with is access to information inquiries. Again, we had a huge backlog that was very, very difficult for us to manage, and we've had to make some fairly draconian decisions around that so we can actually start again. But for us as an organisation, it's probably one of the most difficult decisions we've had or difficult predicament we've had to face is our inability to be as transparent and as accountable as we possibly can be.
I appreciate this must be really difficult for staff who are working very, very hard to get this all back up and running. Can I just ask what this means in practice? So if I, as a MSP for Central Scotland, want to get information about a site in Lanarkshire, I can't go online today and get that information from the public register. So how do I go about getting the information? Is it available or do I have to physically come to an office?
I think contacting us directly, and there may be ways of getting you that information through information that we hold internally. It's just not very easily accessible, and it's not complete. But I think contacting CEPA in person and asking for that. What we're finding is that, and it's kind of a double-edged sword, is as a result of the The deficiencies in our ability to provide that information proactively, that then people are coming to us through access to information and freedom of information, and those requests are increasing, which then is another area of difficulty and really hard for us to resource. So it's a challenge, but we're working very hard on that and we're investing in those systems. But get in touch with us and we'll...
And that applies to any member of the public in
absolutely.
Scotland?
Absolutely. Even lifting the phone to our contact information, our contact centre.
I'm really interested in what you've been saying. Thank you for being so open. So if more people are having to resort to freedom of information, does that mean SEPA is getting bogged down with FOI requests?
We have been, but over the last year we've made good inroads in that. We had a response time, I think it was 10% of the requests a year ago or so were being done in the time allowed by the process, and now we're up to, in July it was up to 80%. So we're moving on that, and we're putting more resources into it. But it is a challenging area, and will continue to be.
Okay, I just want to pivot back slightly on funding and resource. This is my sort of final question, because there has been some pretty harsh criticism. You know, and I'm sure you've read it the same as we have. Kim Pratt from Friends of the Earth Scotland said, this was in the Ferret, who did a big investigation. 3 years on, the excuse that SEPA is still recovering from a cyber attack is wearing thin. So that's quite hard to hear. But I go back to the comments from your two former CEOs who are very concerned about your funding situation. And the question has been asked, is SEPA a priority for the Scottish Government? So it's a question I think, you know, I can put to you, Mr. Hartley. Do you feel that SEPA is enough of a priority for the Scottish Government?
So we're very much focused on moving forward from the cyber attack. So it pains me in this session to actually have to refer to it. We're moving forward and we're going to build back better. I think we are being supported. We're working. The critical thing is that prioritisation. We're working very closely with government officials and under the banner of public sector reform to get that joint understanding of prioritisation of what we're going to concentrate on going forward. And that's what we're concentrating on. I think if we do that, then we can manage with the finances that's available to us. But it remains a challenging time. And there are also other efficiencies about how we can run our estate, for example, our buildings, and sharing with others. There's other things we can do as well to be more efficient.
Thank you, Mr. Hartley. I wish you and your colleagues well. I'll hand back to the convener.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm afraid, David, there are still some questions to come. One is from Jackie Dunbar. I don't know why I called you Jackie Bailey. I apologise. I'll pay for it later, I know. Jackie.
Thank you, convener. It was just a supplementary to Monica's first question in regards to enforcement. David said that nobody notices unless enforcement happens. So that made me kind of think, if David could maybe expand on that a bit for us. Does SEPA go straight to enforcement for non-compliance? Or is it a last resort? If you could maybe talk us through it a little bit, that would be helpful.
It's a last resort. Our enforcement policy might be worth sending to you, actually, because what's very much clear in that is that we will work with those who are non-compliant to achieve compliance. So we're very much a helping hand. However, it does depend on the circumstances. If people are trying to do the right thing, we will help them do the right thing, and we will only wield the stick when we need to at the end of that process. And that does happen. If somebody's a chancer and willfully or criminal, then we will come in hard with the big stick. And we've got various tools to do that with, including writing reports to the Procurator Fiscal. So it is a range of approaches very much dependent on the circumstance.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Mark, I think you've got a question you want to ask in this section here.
Yes, I did. Just staying with David Hartley there. It's about the Environmental Standards Scotland Air Quality Report. There are a number of recommendations that were made about how SEPA progresses its enforcement on air quality issues. So I wanted to ask you about what changes are planned on the back of that. how has it actually affected your enforcement action on the ground?
So air quality management in Scotland is shared through various agencies. We directly regulate large industrial emissions to air. We also support local authorities in terms of the data we provide and the modelling and advisory expertise in terms of how they manage air quality within their within those localities. We also have an ability to take action against local authorities if we feel they haven't done enough. Now, we've not used that duty yet. We feel that we're working very much in partnership with local authorities. That is something we could consider if we felt that local authorities weren't doing enough in terms of local air pollution. So we feel we're doing okay with that, very aware of that investigation, but we think we're doing okay.
Okay. So no other changes then on the back of ESS's review?
No significant changes that I'm aware of.
Right.
I can follow up in more detail if that helps.
Yeah, it might be useful.
Just focusing in on the recommendations.
One thing that was highlighted to us when we were doing a kind of mini inquiry into air quality in ESS's review was the positive role that SEPA plays in the development of air quality management plans, particularly, you know, working with local communities, enhancing data, helping that public understanding of what an air quality problem is in a particular locality and what the solutions might be. Given one of the ESS's recommendations was that we need to see local authorities develop more of these plans and to develop them within 12 months, are you able to resource that side of things? So if there was a new group that was set up, for example, in Perth or somewhere else to help develop an air quality action plan for the area, would you be able to resource that, that demand?
We would probably struggle to have a significant uplift in resources on that if it went across the country in the same way that it has done in some of the, like in Glasgow, for example. We're very proud of that work that we've done locally with communities, and it's gone very well. That would be a challenge if that significantly, if there's a big uptick in that sort of work. That is grant and aid work. That is not something we can directly recover from.
Okay. So that's useful to know. Convener, I'm just going to move on to another question that I have here, and it's really a kind of bigger picture question about climate change plan and also the biodiversity strategy. And I wanted to ask, both Nature Scot and SEPA about your views. I mean, how are you inputted into both those strategies? And do you see a way that we can, create synergy between tackling both climate and biodiversity, or are there tensions in there? We mentioned wind farm development already. Are there ways that we can maximise biodiversity gains while at the same time developing more ambition and more on the ground on climate?
Who would you like to ask first, Mark?
Nick Halfhite would be good.
Okay. Yes, as you say, a very wide-ranging question. So we've been very closely involved in developing the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy. So very closely involved in that. We have also been working closely with officials in Scottish Government on the climate change plan, obviously the one about reducing emissions, but also on the climate change adaptation. So, and the three of those are obviously, there's a huge amount of overlap around those, particularly around the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy and reducing emissions, because about 50% of Scotland's emissions are related to the land in one way or another. They're also a major opportunity for sequestering carbon through woodlands and peatlands in good condition. And then we also know that looking forward, as the climate becomes more chaotic, that one of our best kind of insurance policies for dealing with that more chaotic climate is going to be a more robust natural environment. I mean, and the science tells us that that's the way to go, whether we're looking at reducing flooding, a natural environment in better condition. It won't stop flooding, but it will reduce some of the challenges around that. It's also one of the ways of helping deal with water scarcity issues and drought issues if the land is in better condition. So they are absolutely interconnected. And in helping develop the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, we have had a very firm eye both on climate change mitigation and adaptation. There are a few tensions in there. They are bound to be. You mentioned one about wind farms. These aren't insurmountable, I think, the ones around renewable. They just need very careful working through. Where there are maybe a fewer, more intractable tensions are around land use. We have a finite amount of land and finite amount of seed, for that matter. What we do with it is really, really important. And there will be challenges how we increase the land that we make available for nature, how we increase the amount of land that we have available for kind of adaptation, sequestration, how we produce all the food that we need to eat. And sort of bioenergy crops are maybe at the centre of one of the particular kind of tensions within all of that. Should we be using land to grow crops for energy when we need that land to be doing all those other things, and where there may actually be alternatives to using bioenergy? I use that as a kind of the classic example of where I think there are tensions, but I would say 90-95% there's a very good overlap, complementarity.
Okay. So would you agree then that, you know, dialogue with industries is really important? And, you know, I've heard, for example, from the onshore wind industry, some criticism of NatureScot that you didn't consult with the industry on the development of peatland guidance. So I just wonder if you're aware of that, and you know, how NatureScot really, you know, prioritises that good quality engagement with different sectors that, you know, obviously have a vested interest in terms of, you know, developing the land, including renewable sector, but clearly, you know, we need to find a way through on these issues and ensure that development can proceed, but in a way which supports both the objectives of climate and biodiversity.
Yeah, I wasn't aware of that particular criticism, but I would say one of the things we pride ourselves in is working very closely with all of those sectors to whom we interact. So the renewable sector, we work very closely with them. But clearly they have a slightly different objective at times. So whether it's on peatland code and enabling some applications to go ahead with conditions that they will then restore areas of peat, that's an area we've worked hard with. On the onshore side, in the offshore industry, we've worked very hard with the sector about where they place the turbines, how they service them, and how that can be conditions can be put on to help the development go ahead in such a way that it is sensitive to, and indeed in some instances helps to restore the nature that is being displaced or killed. So I think we work really closely with all industries, whether it's the farming sector, whether it's the renewable sector, and so on.
Okay. Well, the criticism is that there hadn't been any consultation, is what I was told, with the renewables industry, but maybe that's something that you can go away and reflect on. Okay, can we get a view on CEPA then, on how we square the climate and biodiversity?
Yeah, like Nick, I think there's huge synergies between both global issues, and we should concentrate on where those synergies are. Huge overlap. Essentially, I think when natural systems fail, and we are talking about systems failure, you get that degradation, but then if you're able to rebuild the system, you get huge multiple benefits. That's for many, many areas. For example, just one example in the area of land management. I mean, more trees by rivers. It sounds very simple, doesn't it? But more trees by rivers increases the carbon sequestration, protects from flooding in an increasingly that'll come about from climate change, protects the soil, so we enable sustainable food production, biodiversity improvement, potentially amenity improvement, fisheries protection, fisheries resilience from the shading from the trees. There are strategies that we can use that have big multiple benefits that I think in a very, very complicated world, we should concentrate on those win-win areas.
Okay. So that's something that you fed directly into both the biodiversity strategy and the forthcoming climate plan then?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Mark. The next questions come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. I think my first question is it's both my questions is regarding water quality, but the first question would probably be is for David. Last year we discussed the issues of monitoring sewage overflows with SEPA, and we also raised the concerns that stakeholders had regarding the small percentage that was being monitored. Can you give us an update today on the progress that's been made since then? You know, has monitoring increased, and what the impact of sewage and overflows is currently having on our water environment?
So we're the regulator in this. Scottish Water is the provider of the monitoring, but I can give you an update. I won't speak on their behalf, but we do hold them to account on their improving urban water courses plan, which includes which is fairly multifaceted, but absolutely includes a monitoring. I think there's 3,000 plus combined sewage overflows in Scotland, of which currently there are about 10% which are monitored, but they're very quickly increasing that to a third. So there's going to be 1,000 monitors, and that's already underway. I can give you much more on the exact timescales on that. So moving fast in that area. In terms of water quality and sewage, and in terms of ecological water quality, even though there's a lot of concern from the public, and I do understand that, the impact on a national scale is quite low compared to other impacts on the water environment, say, for example, from land use, from diffuse pollution from land use. That's not to say that there aren't some parts of more urbanised areas of Scotland where this is a problem, and it's been exacerbated by development and particularly by climate change and increasingly flashier flooding. And those areas need to be dealt with. There's a really interesting question here about, when I mentioned good ecological water quality, that's not the same as good bathing water quality, which isn't the same either as good potable water quality. So there's I think there's a big public education opportunity here so that people understand the differences between what's safe for bathing and the requirements around that, and what's sufficient for good or better ecological water quality. So we have a plan for the good ecological water. For both, we have the River Basin Management Plan, which sets targets across all the impacts on the water environment, across all our 3,000 water bodies, to where they're less than good status. There's a plan in place, they are ministerial objectives to improve waters across Scotland. And that includes sewage, but also includes from agriculture, from abstractions, and a host of other impacts. But Scotland's, just last point, Scotland's water quality is in good condition. It's 85% of Scotland's water bodies are in good or better in terms of water quality.
Sorry, Jackie, can I just ask just a quick question on that? So what you're kind of saying is that the environment, it might be fine for the environment, but for God's sake, don't drink it, and the last thing you should do is swim in it. Is that what you're saying?
I'm not saying that. I'm saying there are. I'm saying there are different. There's different requirements for different purposes. So in terms of the environment, for drinking water, you can understand why you might have a very, very stringent requirement. There's no bacteria at all in that water. There's no contaminants.
Well, that's because it's got chlorine.
There's a very good reason, and other treatment. Although I won't speak for Scottish Water, but so that's the highest standard for bathing water. There's a very high standard, particularly in relation to the presence of bacteria and viruses. And in those places which are designated for bathing water, we monitor and for those pollutants, and we require improvements accordingly in line with European standards.
So is it fine to swim in every river in Scotland?
I don't think it is fine to swim in every urban river in Scotland. I think that, but I think public, this is why the monitoring is really important. I think public education and awareness is really important. There are times of the year and weather conditions where the risks are much less, but after a large shower in the middle of summer, that would not be the best time in some areas.
Thank you. You've just given me an excuse not to go swimming with my wife. Sorry, back to Jackie Dunbar.
Okay, thank you. So, on the back of that, how do we find out what rivers are safe to swim in? Because I used to swim in a river in a kid, as a kid, and never gave it much thought. You know, how does the public out there find out where it is safe and where it's not safe? And also, David, I can quickly ask you, I know you said you couldn't give me a timescale, but you, regarding increasing the monitoring to a third, but, I mean, are we expecting it by the end of this year, the end of spring, next year? You know, are you able to give us an indication of that?
I think it's in the coming years. I don't have that exactly to hand, but I think I can. But Scottish Water have a website with their progress against these targets. Improving urban watercourses is the name of the their project on this, and we can forward that link and pull out the specific areas. You asked me a question. Oh yeah, where is it safe?
Where can I go for a duke?
We could definitively say that it's safe to swim in Scotland, in designated bathing beaches. And where there's a situation after heavy rainfall where that bathing beach might not be safe, there's information available at the beach to inform people, and we have a role in providing that information. It's a really tricky area about the rest of the environment. It does depend. I mean, we don't know what land management practices are happening. For example, you could go for a swim in the Highlands somewhere where you think it's absolutely safe to swim, and there could be a dead deer in the river a mile upstream. It is impossible to give a definitive on that. But I do think there's a huge public awareness element on this that we're very much part of, so that people can make decisions based on the environment that they see around them and the conditions that they see around them. And I do think the monitoring of the CSOs is part of that. But I think there could be something much more holistic which helps people, because there's been a huge increase in wild swimming over the last 3 years, and an understandable increase in concern.
Okay, thank you. My next question I'm going to put to both of you. So I'm going to ask Nick first to give David a bit of a break because maybe get a touch of water. There is a programme for government commitment to develop legislation on adaptation of water infrastructure to deal with future water scarcity. Can you tell us how water scarcity is impacting on your organisation's functions, and what role would you like to have, or indeed expect to have, in developing the new legislation going forward?
Thanks very much. The main impact of water scarcity on our organisation is in relation to protected sites and protected species. So if there is a period of drought, we will work closely with Scottish Water and SEPA and local authorities on where they might need to use alternative sources. And if, for example, that were to be their backup source is a protected site, we will work closely with them on levels that might be appropriate before that site is adversely impacted. And there have been live cases on Skye. There was one this year, and we are expecting those to increase, as all the research we have seen suggests that there will be more severe and more regular periods of drought throughout Scotland as climate change happens. And then there's impact on species. Most water species are reasonably mobile, so our greatest concern is freshwater pearl mussels. This happens regularly in one or two of the rivers, particularly up north, where in periods of drought we work very closely, particularly with SEPA, on whether or not to move populations of mussels to deeper water. It's a tricky one because we're not sure that that the survival rates of moving these creatures is that high. So sometimes it's better to leave them there, and there's an absolute judgment to be made, and depending on the circumstances. So that's how it impacts us specifically on our roles. And the second part was, yes, what role would we want to play? We're not a leading light, as it were, in the water world, but we would absolutely want to make sure that the interests of our protected sites, our protected species, are taken account of as that those regulations come forward. But also the wider environment. We know from the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, and indeed, as I mentioned, from the climate change adaptation, It's not just our protected sites that are important. They're only 18% of the land at the moment. Actually, all our land matters. So we need to make sure that even in sites that aren't designated, that the approaches to how we manage our water resource is given much higher priority, whether it's in farmland, in our uplands, or wherever, because we've rather taken water for granted. I mean, it kind of rains a lot, but all the climate change projections suggest we're going to have to look after our water resource as if it were much more scarce. And it's interesting that when we look at where we might go in the future, we're looking to places like East Anglia in England for how the northeast of Scotland might progress in the future, looking at the strategies they have there, not only for the water management, for drinking water and agriculture, but also for its impact on protected sites and species.
OK, thank you. And I probably should declare my interest as Nature's Champion for the sea trout, which I discussed at my recent members' business debate. If I can go to David now, please.
Yeah, I think we're more directly involved. It's been a busy couple of summers, the last two summers for us. A lot of effort and good work done in helping the country through two water scarcity incidents. And this is why climate change resilience is right up there in our priorities going forward, not just from having too much water around the country, but also in terms of having too little. Our main roles are one of expertise and information. And we are the organisation that must understand that, must understand the risks going forward and project where things are going to get difficult in the country, both in terms of within an event, but also in terms of that long-term understanding. We're very proud of our weekly report. We have a two-page weekly report throughout the summer, which is really factual, really a very helpful service, I think, to the country in a very elemental way. On the back of that, we also regulate abstraction, so we have an understanding of where the water has been taken from the water environment, and we regulate to the standards within those licences. We have a water scarcity plan, which, when we find ourselves in a water scarcity situation, has a stepwise series of actions ranging from the provision of advice in the early stages, working with operators on how they can be more water efficient, moving right through to potentially removing their ability to take that water. And there's been times over the last couple of years where we've actually had to do that. And that's a very, that's very challenging for all concerned. But we're working closely with the legislation you mentioned, with the government officials on that. One area that has been discussed is whether we could have a more defined role in terms of the assessment of water scarcity in relation to private water supplies. But we're very, very close working. We've actually got joint teams, multi-agency teams, working with Scottish Government on that legislation. So very close.
OK, thank you. I've no further questions just now, Convener, so I'll hand back to you.
Thanks very much, Jackie. I think, Mark, you wanted to come in with a question when we were talking about water quality, and also I think you've got a further question after that. Mark.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Yeah, I just want to go back to David on the bathing water quality designation process, because my understanding is that in Scotland there's a minimum threshold of 150 daily users that's required in any kind of application for a bathing water designation. That differs to England and Wales, where I think there is either no requirement threshold for daily users or a very, very much lower number. I think in England it's around 40. Is that an area that CEPRA are looking at in terms of reform and making suggestions to ministers? Because I think your point earlier on was it's all fine in designated bathing water quality areas, at least over an entire season. But, you know, if you can't get your area that you regularly wild swim in designated, then, you know, who's monitoring that? And how are we getting that kind of partnership approach to address the problems of pollution in these areas that people are using, but maybe not at the 150 threshold limit?
Yeah, I'm aware of that that issue, Mark. Our Minister, sorry. that process is... that decision-making is made by ministers. and it's what we do help Scottish Government in relation to and supporting that process. I think that could be done. There are very real implications on what that means in terms of expenditure on increasing the water quality in those areas. It would not be insignificant if we found ourselves with double or treble of the number of bathing waters. As I said, there is a difference in standard required sort of for environmental standards in terms of bathing water standards, and that would have to be taken into the mix. But that would be a question for government to weigh up the pros and cons of that.
Okay, thanks. And if I can just stay with yourself, David, and maybe bring Nick back in, and ask you about the retained EU law bill. I mean, obviously now this bill is an act. Perhaps a dramatic cliff edge of a lot of EU legislation being rescinded has not materialised. But nevertheless, the act is in place. You perhaps have noted the committee's interest in the National Air Quality Performance Framework and how that particular legislation is now being withdrawn through the bill, and there's a lack of clarity about how that will be replaced, what it will be replaced with. I wanted to see if I have reflections on the retained EU law bill and where we are now and what the implications are for our environmental standards.
Well, I guess the lead, that would really be with Scottish Government officials to manage that and work through that. But we haven't seen a significant shift in what we do, and going forward, we don't expect it. For example, in the water environment, that river basin management planning process, which is really quite powerful, driven by the Water Framework Directive, is something which we don't see any change in expectation around that. And we welcome that. So we're not seeing a significant shift on the at the coalface.
Okay. And Nick, I don't know if you have any reflections on that from biodiversity provisions or...
Yes, I mean, just two points to make here. I think one is, we're not seeing much change overall either in terms of our continual kind of engagement and alignment to laws that originally came from Europe. But what we are unsure about is the impact of that new piece of legislation in Westminster on the supremacy of EU case law. And that is an area that is still unclear, and we're not expecting it to have been clarified by the 1st of January, but is potentially, in the medium term, an area of concern, because we do rely quite a lot on that case law. And if it were not to be relevant any longer, then that would have some impact on some of our decisions around licensing in particular.
Okay. Have you got a particular example of that? I mean, are we looking at offshore wind or particular areas where there's a weight of EU case law and interpretation of key environmental principles that now could be challenged? Or?
I don't have a very specific example, but I know we have relied on that case law in some of our planning advice around species, European protected species, for example.
Okay. Thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. I think that draws us to an end of questions on this session. So, in case I don't do it after the next session, thank you for both you, Nick, and David giving evidence to the committee this morning. It's always useful to hear what's going on and what's being achieved. So I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting till 10:55, where we'll move on to our next evidence session. So suspend the meeting. really. Our next item of business is an evidence session with the environmental bodies as part of the committee's stage one scrutiny of the Circular Economy Scotland Bill. This is our second session on the bill following a panel with business stakeholders last week. And I'd like to welcome back Nick Halfide, the Director of Nature and Climate Change for Nature Scot, David Harley, the Chief Officer for Circular Economy, Scottish Environmental Protection Agency. And I'm also pleased to welcome Ian Gulland, the Chief Executive Officer of Zero Waste Scotland. There are a list of questions and to do with this. And I was I've read your evidence to the committee, and I just wanted in a brief sentence from both Nick and David, or a couple of sentences, is do you support the bill and do we need it? Nick?
Yes, we do need it. And yes, we do support it. And the reason we need it is because the matters it deals with are one of the indirect drivers of biodiversity loss. We need to, so I think I'm going over your couple of sentences, but we absolutely need to get to reduce our use and make better use of our material flows. Where we would extend not the bill, but the conversation, is into organic flows as well, but we'll maybe come on to that in a bit.
David.
Absolutely, we need it. Around 80% of Scotland's carbon footprint comes from products and services we manufacture, use and throw away, essentially our consumption. Scotland's consumption per capita, or our material footprint, is double the world average, and that's just unsustainable. This circular economy is a game-changing opportunity to meet Scotland's climate change targets and ambitions, create new industries and economic opportunities, and reduce the harms associated with waste management.
Okay, so one of the important things about the bill must be to ensure that we take the public with it and get the public to support it. The problem is there's a lot of enabling legislation within the bill. There's not often a lot of clarity. Do you think public support would be enhanced by more clarity rather than just enabling legislation? Nick, do you want to kick off on that?
I'm not sure I've got much to say about that. That's a sort of almost like a political judgment, isn't it?
As an organisation, you'd love enabling legislation because it could enable you to do a huge amount of things, but it doesn't allow the public necessarily to see what's behind it. You can dodge it.
I'm just saying there's a lot in that about the role of legislation, primary legislation and secondary legislation. I mean, there's quite a lot to be said for having as much detail as you can in primary, but we tend to be in a system where a lot of that goes into secondary legislation, and therefore that's where the scrutiny happens. I'm not answering your question.
Well, no, I mean, I think as a parliamentarian, I'm trying to push the fact that enabling legislation allows for less scrutiny. Scrutiny happens when things are on the face of the bill. Ian, I'm going to bring you in because you might have a view on this, or you might not.
Yeah, and if I could, just going back to your first question, if I could.
Well, I kind of guessed your answer to the first one, but I'm very happy.
Yeah, no, I suppose, but I think we talked about the environment, obviously, in the climate emergency, but I think we do need to just reflect on the context of the circular economy in terms of our economic opportunity here, you know, and that's not just in terms of businesses. You know, this is a much bigger, you know, thinking about the use of resources globally here now and the impact of that on the global economy, the geopolitics and everything that's involved in it. And that's what's really driving the kind of real shift in the circular economy. So it's not just about our climate ambitions and environment. Absolutely, these things are critical. to our survival, but thinking about our broader economy as we go forward, particularly around the net zero transition, then thinking about our use of resources and reducing our consumption, thinking more about the materials we already have in supply here in this country is really going to be critical to our success, and that feeds into our kind of broader well-being of our communities and our citizens here in Scotland. So, yeah, I do think, I think, to be honest, the public are more on board with us than you'd imagine. I suspect a lot of the driver to have enabling legislation, and then to get into more of the detail, is actually to engage more with some of the key stakeholders in terms of some of the industries and some of the businesses that could be affected, hopefully positively, by the shift to the circular economy. So I generally think citizens of Scotland really get the consumption piece. You know, when you talk about climate change, particularly the impact on biodiversity loss, not just here in Scotland but globally, that is very visible to them. It's very visible in the media. They're very much aware that they need to start making choices, different choices. What they want to be enabled to make those choices, and that is down to businesses and key sectors, and even, you know, local authorities and people on the ground to help and support the accessibility for people to make the right choices. So I actually think, you know, the kind of secondary legislation idea is really about getting into those more in-depth conversations with key stakeholder groups, many of which are possibly just the circular economy is a bit newer than some other of the groups that have been working with, who are coming to the fore and really trying to get immersed in the opportunities that are in front of us.
Okay, David, do you want to add anything to
I agree with what Ian said there. I guess the one thing I would add is that just in terms down to individual behaviours, we do have a problem in Scotland. 60% of the material in residual waste, so that's in the you know, your black bag or the bin, that the stuff that isn't going to be recycled, could be recycled, 60%, and that's stuck. We've got 43% recycling rates, which is plateaued. So there is a public element to this, which is really important. Public awareness and encouragement in that area is fundamental to all of this.
Okay, great. The next question comes from Mark. Sorry, did you want to come in? Hold on, Mark, before I bring you in, the Deputy Convener's caught my eye, wants to come in with a follow-up on that.
Thank you very much, Convener. And just on that point, Mr. Harley, I think you touched on such an important element here, that there's a way to go in terms of taking the public with us through the different means to nudge and encourage punish if necessary, and we'll get onto that later in the bill. Does the fact that there's a secondary legislation process following any primary legislation passed in terms of this bill, is that necessitated because of the need to walk through the process in terms of implementation and also greater awareness raising amongst the public?
Yeah, I think so. I think, like Ian said, I think we need to. There's a mix of actions that can be taken here, from system-wide to individual. And I think we need to, and also there's a danger with a system as complicated as this of unintended consequences. So I think it's important to get to walk this through with the public and to get it right, to get the right targets set and the right measures and the right set of interventions.
And the secondary legislation gives that flexibility. Yeah. Thank you, Camilla.
Okay. Mark, sorry, having introduced you and then cut you off, I'm now going to introduce you again, Mark.
Thank you very much. So can I turn now to the disposal of unsold goods in Scotland, how much of a problem that is, which sectors or products are particularly problematic for the environment? Can you start with Ian, actually, on that one?
Thanks, Mark. I'm not sure I have the details in front of me about the actual amounts, so maybe that's something I can feed back at a later date. But obviously, we know it's an issue from the kind of online shopping phenomenon, that people return stuff, and the logistics operation is not really set up to receive that stuff back. So there's a growing challenge around some of the online operators and in-store take back as well, what to do with that. So we know it's a growing challenge for those operators, and it's something, you know, to some extent, they've been set up to distribute the stuff, but not to take it back. So the obvious thing at the back end of their logistics is just to dispose of that stuff as quickly as possible and get out of the system. So that's really the challenge. How can we then bring forward legislation or regulation to ensure that these organisations are then thinking about that end of life? So just as well, they're focusing on how to get the material or the products out to the customer, then what are they going to do with them when they come back in? So I think that's really important. And I think genuinely all of the certainly the bigger companies that we speak to are very on this, they're very aware of this. It's a cost, obviously. I mean, we're, you know, it's, don't have the figures again, but we're talking globally, you know, billions of pounds, particularly in the textile trade, for returns that businesses are having to deal with. So that's a cost that they're either bearing or they're passing on through their supply chains. So it's in their interest to come up with avenues to kind of, you know, not just to do the right thing in terms of the environment, but obviously to reduce their costs and think about those. But it's the scale of the challenge, I think, which is daunting to most of them, if you were to have them in the room, and how do they reorientate their reverse logistics, which that's not what they've set themselves up, and how do they then partner with people at the back end of the system to actually make sure that they're, you know, not disposing, but they're reusing and making available those products again for, you know, to keep the products in circulation over and over again. But it also offers the chance for those businesses to think differently about their model. I mean, ultimately, that's what the circular economy is about. So while that's just trying to tidy up the retail environment, how could we change that retail environment so people are not thinking about product, you know, as a sale, but how do they think about subscription services? How do they think about leasing and rental systems, or engaging with different actors in the supply chain that could provide a different type of servitisation rather than a product? So that's, so hopefully by enabling this legislation that way, is not just going to tidy up the reverse logistics operation, but get businesses of every shape and size to think differently about their model, that ultimately just passing or selling things is not the future. We need to think differently about that model.
Yeah. So in terms of the conversations that Zero Waste Scotland has had with particular sectors, particular scales, businesses, what kind of feedback have you had? Are there any concerns around unintended consequences or other issues?
We haven't found any unintended consequences. I mean, the conversation has been very positive for the companies that we've engaged with. Again, it's for some of them, you know, it's the scale of the take-backs and having outlets for that, particularly at a local level, to redistribute that. So some of that's a challenge. Some of them, it's not just what happens here in Scotland. You were talking certainly UK-wide companies or global companies, so it's not just a Scottish challenge. But it is something that they're engaging with, and they are keen to support measures that will help them, because, as I say, it's a cost. It's a cost that has been having to be passed on to somebody, and they are very interested. That, you know, obviously, in terms of their wider sustainability challenges, they recognise that this is something that they can't keep on doing. To some extent, the spotlight's on a lot of those companies as well. And new companies who are coming onto the market, whether that's, you know, smaller SMEs, Scottish-owned companies, are very aware of this, because obviously they're being pushed into the online space. That's obviously, you know, where consumers are now much more comfortable in that space. So, that, you know, again, they're then challenged with that as well. So it's something that getting in early with those companies to think about what happens to returns and what happens to that sort of model going forward, I think, is quite encouraging, I think. I've seen a lot of interest in a different type of model, but that might need different types of platforms, different collaboration across different companies in the same space, whether that's clothing, whether that's electricals. So again, that's, you know, that's possibly new for some of those companies. How could they work much more collaboratively together within a location, whether that's Scotland or regional parts of Scotland? You know, and again, it's something we've talked to the Chambers of Commerce through our work through the Circular Cities, is trying to understand, is the actual solutions that we could put in place at a local level that could actually help those businesses individually, but more importantly, create opportunities, you know, both economically and socially within those locations, but ultimately try and reduce the consumption, because this can't be seen as just cleaning up the kind of back end of an inefficient retail operation. This has to be seen within the wider context of reducing our overall consumption.
Mm-hmm. What are those positive opportunities then? I mean, you talked about more of a kind of local approach to redistributing goods. although ultimately, you know, we're trying to reduce the amount of unsold goods just being distributed like that. But do you see, you know, what are the kind of positive opportunities or discussions that you've been having for businesses that are under development at the moment?
Well, some of it is about, I mean, getting into reverse logistics, some of it is simply about having the space. You know, these operations are not, they're not set up to receive things back in. So having that space available to them, and again, you know, rather than them all having the space, could it be shared space, and having then either themselves or a logistical partner, and that could be within the social enterprise sector or the community sector, to provide the actual mechanism to redistribute that stuff, if that's what the answer is. I actually think there's a role there for local authorities, potentially, to think how could they facilitate that, you know, facilitate that particularly at a local level, rather than think, you know, so again, multiple companies working together would be much more efficient and effective to some extent than every company trying to deal with it themselves. Because that's the challenge. They're all trying to think about it themselves, but actually it would fit. And there might be other operations. I mean, we've had work with conversations with the NHS as well, so they have their own similar challenges around things like walking aids and other equipment being returned. And again, they have a big distribution network, but they're not really set up to bring all that stuff back in. So there might be partnerships, you know, utilising some of the public agencies as well who have similar challenges, possibly not at the same scale as the online retailers, but certainly they have similar challenges. And it is, mm-hmm. How can we work collaboratively to create that efficiencies? But again, as you said, it's not the whole answer. We need to start thinking much smarter about that consumption piece up front as well, so we don't end up with all of these things residing in a warehouse trying to find a home.
Yeah. Okay. So if I can turn into SEPA just about how a ban on unsold good disposal could be enforced, go ask for your reflections on that.
I don't have a huge amount to say in addition to Ian. We're broadly supportive of the principle. The one thing that we would urge caution on is that it really needs to be, where this is applied needs to be supported by good evidence to make sure we don't have unintended consequences.
Okay, but I mean, would we expect SEPA to be the enforcement body?
That's a possibility, absolutely. Yep.
Right. Okay. So what discussions have been taking place?
I'm not aware of discussions in detail about how that's practically done. I'm not sure that's happened yet.
Okay. I mean, that's obviously pretty critical to this bill, so it would be good if SEPA could write back to the committee and detail how you may take on those duties and how monitoring could take place as well around compliance.
Yes, we can do that.
Yes, okay. Good. Any views from Nature, Scott?
Nothing on this, thank you.
Okay. Yeah, back to you,
Convene. Thank you, Mark. And just before we move away from this, I've got a question, but I should say, Mark, the committee did write to one of the big suppliers in Scotland, Amazon, and ask if they'd like to come and give evidence to the committee on this subject about redistribution. And unfortunately, they're not prepared to come and give physical evidence committee. They have offered written evidence. It would have been so much stronger to hear from them in person, I think. But just go back to the disposable of unused goods. Is there a concern that if it's not kept pace across the whole of the United Kingdom, that companies in Scotland might move stuff south of the border to avoid this regulation, just saying that it still can be used in other parts of the United Kingdom. Would that concern you, Ian, or do you think that's totally impossible to happen?
Yeah, it would obviously concern me. I mean, it is possible. I mean, I guess... My answer would be it depends on how the regulations are set and how that's monitored to make sure that that doesn't happen against the regulations. But I think engagement with the companies would help to try and understand, you know, the opportunity that they see doing something in Scotland. I definitely think this is a journey that all these people are on. So, you know, and you know, by going down this route as well, you know, said all the benefits, like, you know, pushing things further up the kind of hierarchy, so to speak, and getting people to think differently about their business model. You know, one of the challenges, well, one of the opportunities could be a lot of these retailers could see the opportunity to resell that stuff within their stores, because that's something they're not doing. You know, the stuff goes out the back door, and okay, some of it gets into other markets, some of it gets handed over to charities, but they're kind of washing their hands of it because it's not new. But actually, encouraging them to see this as part of their business model, their business strategy. Some of them are very interested in that. You know, it's a bit like who wants to go first, and we're already seeing some of the bigger retailers thinking about, you know, selling second-hand clothing in store in some of the bigger retail. So you're beginning to see that creep into the high street already. So anything that really encourages them to think that this is part of your business model is to do this, I think will be well received, because they'll start to see this and that they might embrace this as a way of something that they could then replicate in other parts, certainly of the UK, if not abroad. So it's about, you know, to some extent helping them get over what they see as quite a big challenge within their wider business model.
So if SEPA were going to be the regulator of this, do you think there might be problems with a company moving stuff around the United Kingdom or even around Europe or wherever to avoid having to comply with, say, more stringent conditions in Scotland? And David, are you confident you could be on top of that as SEPA?
I think it makes it more challenging. I think the level playing field across the UK is definitely easier. It would make the regulatory job more challenging if there's a different approach in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK.
And just, Ian, I'll come back to you, but just also maybe you'll just address the fact that if I was struggling to, say, sell items, I might be prepared to give it to a charity to allow them to use or sell it. But if they don't sell it, they then take on the obligations of the disposal of it, do they not? Would that frighten charities, or do you think they'd have confidence they could keep shifting items through? Ian?
Yeah, so that kind of leads on to what my other answer I was going to say. See, part of this, sometimes we can't look at this in isolation. So if we're bringing in something like this, we need to think about exactly that, the supply chain or the broader system. So what will again, stop the retailers or whoever we're talking about, the online, you know, trying to circumvent this, is if we create the right market opportunity in Scotland. So whether that is working with charitable sector, social enterprises, or creating a different model for them, a platform for them, whether that's actually reusing some of that equipment into different functions. So we create that market here in Scotland. So if we don't create the market, absolutely, all of those will be challenges. You know, they won't find the outlets, or they'll lack confidence in the markets that are already available. So how do we? We're going to go down this route. We could pick textiles, we could pick electrical goods, we could pick beds, you name it. We have to embrace the sector that's going to be behind that, whether that's the charity sectors you've said or the social enterprises, create the right system, the right ecosystem that sits behind that. So that's what this is about, the circular economy. It's a system approach rather than seeing these things in isolation and saying it's all on you to solve this out, because that will happen. We've seen that. You know, we're very good at, you know, you've probably heard me say before, we're very good at recycling in Scotland, you know, both at household level and business level, but, you know, the vast bulk of that material now gets shipped out of our country. Apart from organics and glass, most of the material that we collect for recycling goes somewhere else, because we haven't set up the systems, we haven't set up the reprocessing infrastructure and the kind of market to make that a much more viable proposition. So for every job there is in recycling, collection and recycling, there's 8 jobs further up in terms of the reprocessing, resupply of those materials back into the economy. That's the economic opportunity we want to embrace. So if we go down this route, let's think about the system that sits behind it and all of the organisations and all of the businesses and all of the sectors and all of the citizens who will come around that and make this happen for Scotland.
I share your enthusiasm for making it work. It concerns me we're being asked to pass a bill which will enable this, and we haven't really got all the details behind it to make it work or understand them in my mind. Anyway, I'm going to go to the Deputy Convener, Ben.
Thank you, Convener, and we'll come on to household waste again in due course, but I would like to ask some questions to the panel about charges for single-use items. Just to start off, how should the Scottish Government strategically use powers for single-use charging, which is, of course, proposed in the bill, to support a transition to a circular economy? And what role can charges play alongside potentially multiple other measures or options, such as producer responsibility, deposit return, and any relevant taxation? I don't know who wants to come in on that first. Maybe David? Thank you.
Yeah, I think, like Ian said, this is all part of the system, and I think it has a role to play in conjunction with the other parts, with the other levers. Absolutely.
I mean, in that, do you think it's important not to overemphasise the contribution of single-use charges and make sure that it's presented and considered within a wider
absolutely.
Suite of measures to reduce waste and encourage upcycling and recycling?
Yeah, and I think this is where the evidence base, and I know it's kind of a dry statement, the evidence base, but it's so important to get this right. The information, the data, the understanding, the behaviourals, all of that, understanding that in the interplay is crucial to the successful delivery of this ambition.
And just on that, I mean, in the call for views, just as you've emphasised there, many respondents also emphasised the need for proper life cycle analysis of any new charges to ensure there would be environmental benefits and, crucially, engagement with businesses and consumers to avoid unintended consequences and to make sure that there was a collegiate and collective approach to implementation. Do you think the bill provides a framework for the assessment and engagement required around introducing any new charge? Are you confident that what's in the draft bill is robust enough and appropriate enough?
I'm not familiar with the detail of the actual. You mean in terms of actual engagement required?
Yeah,
I'm not close to the detail in terms of that engagement requirement, but it will be needed because we're talking about a systems change, societal shifts. For us as a regulator, it really puts us in quite a different role in terms of that societal behaviour. Mm-hmm. So engagement is going to be crucial to this. Mm-hmm.
Which does take time, unfortunately, that's the reality. Do any of the other panellists want to come in on these points raised?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, Zero Waste Scotland, as you know, it's one of our key contributions to the circular economy is that evidence base. So we've looked at a number of those opportunities, and we'll continue to do that work with Scottish Government. That's our role, you know, looking at the evidence, both from a life cycle point of view and from behavioural change, what works. But, you know, there's a whole range of options, policy options that could be used. But yeah, a single use charge, you know, we've seen that, you know, I think it's well versed that, you know, we are, as human beings, we're kind of motivated more by loss than by gain. So, you know, that's one of the things. And we have, you know, a successful introduction of the carrier bag levy, single-use carrier bag levy. It's a good example, you know, of taking everybody, you know, through a journey in terms of stakeholders, through the retailers, training, and all of the things that went with that for the successful implementation of that in 2014. So, yes, it can work. You can, you know, there are good examples of that working, but it is about the evidence base and taking people on that journey and making sure there's no unintended consequences and you've thought that through. So, I guess as an evidence-based organisation, you know, that's part of our remit, but also that engagement piece. I mean, that's something that we stand behind is making sure that we're working with partners to engage with industry, businesses, you know, individual retailers, or whoever's involved in this to make sure that they understand and are on the journey with us.
And just building on that, what possible limitations or inconsistencies are there in existing powers to ban single-use items and the proposed powers to introduce charges for single-use items? Are there any points around that you would wish to add, Mr. Gulland, before I bring in Mr. Halfhide?
I don't have that. I think I've more to do with the Environment Act.
I don't have any further to add there.
Thank you. Just on the concept more, on all the questions I've asked, Mr. Halfhide, I don't know if you want to add anything.
Yeah, I was going to add, we're not involved in the kind of the detail of this is very much for my colleagues on the left, but there's kind of a more general point that I thought useful to keep sight of, which is that the kind of behavioural changes we are expecting right across society are pretty profound over the next decades in response to climate change, and why I was so assertive at the start, why we need the circular economy bill is we do need it in its own right, but it is part of of many bits of changes that we're going to need, because the kind of behavioural changes we need in relation to our natural environment are pretty profound, and this is just one part of them about how we use what I think of as kind of inert resources like tin cans or whatever, but it goes right across the piece. As I said earlier on in my introductory, this is how we use all our resources, both inert ones but also the kind of alive ones, and hopefully we'll get on to talking about soils later, because that's one of my favourite topics. But it's in the same sort of space about how we use all our resources and how we need to reduce our pressure on all of them, because they're both direct and indirect drivers of biodiversity loss, but also contribute to our emissions, but also make it harder for us to adapt. And they're all part of that really complicated system.
Absolutely. And just lastly, in terms of charges for single-use items, and let any other colleagues who might want to come in on this topic, but you talked about the success of the carrier bag charge in 2014, an undoubted success environmentally, but also in terms of behavioural change. And it has been argued to us last week by some members of the business community representative groups that the fact that those charges for the plastic bags are able to be put into local causes has, in their view, helped with the collegiate buy-in to the policy, both in terms of implementation and seeing the benefits. So I just wondered if you had any comments on how the net proceeds of charges for single-use items should be used, because there is a different proposal in this piece of legislation as things stand compared with what happens with the 2014 charge for plastic bags.
Absolutely. And obviously, putting a charge on something where there's an alternative is key to this. So in terms of the bag charge, there was an alternative. You could get a reusable bag and continue to get your shopping home conveniently. But I think that's a transparency. I mean, all of it comes down to being upfront and honest with the citizens about what happens to the money, whether it's a tax and it's going back into central coffers or whatever, or it's going to be hypothecated into something else, or it's been gathered at a local level. I think all of those, I think just that transparency, I think, benefits the engagement. And we knew that with the carrier bag charge, engaging with them around what happens to the money, how it's going to be spent. Absolutely. And we know that from, you know, talking to individual citizens, citizens are much more aware of what's happening in their own area, whether that's charities or, you know, provision of recycling services. So they've got an engagement with it. And I don't think we should lose sight of that people genuinely live in a community, live in a place. And if they see a benefit coming back to that place, then, yeah, they're more likely to directly respond to that. So, but some of it's just about transparency, about this isn't, you know, there are examples, not in Scotland, from other countries where certain single-use charging has been seen as a tax, and there's a challenge there about where does it go. It just disappears back into kind of government coffers, and there's no real appreciation of what that's about. But that might have other drivers as well, people trying to avoid paying tax. But maybe that's not a conversation. But there is an opportunity, I think, in taking this legislation forward to both engage with the local community and the local businesses about how best to provide that transparency of where the money goes. But ultimately, you know, it's like the carrier bag charge. The carrier bag charge wasn't about raising money. You know, I think we just have to remember that, and putting a price on whether it's coffee cups or whatever isn't about raising money for good causes. It is about reducing single use. Ideally, we want 100% shift, so actually there'd be no money to be, you know, recirculated within the community. And that's a hard thing to talk about as well. But ultimately, the reality is there will still be some money available. So that's how we do that. But they shouldn't be seen. I guess that's one of the challenges, particularly with the carrier bags, was this wasn't to be seen as a kind of, you know, a fund, an ongoing fund, really.
Okay. Does anyone else want to comment on that point? Okay. Convener, does anyone else want to comment on this issue before?
I'm not seeing any raised hands, Ben, so I think you've got more questions you want to ask, say. we're all ears.
Thank you, Convener. So I'm just now going to move on to the considerations around household waste, which we've touched on briefly already. What impact do you think the strengthening of enforcement measures regarding disposable household waste will have, and how, in your view, should high levels of compliance with household waste and recycling systems be achieved? And is what's in the bill enforceable?
Start. I think it's really helpful to have options there around household waste and then, I guess, enforcement, I guess, around that. But in the mix, and in countries where this works, it's in the mix with a deposit return, you know, something like a deposit return scheme with a powerful producer responsibility framework, and then having that, that sort of householder responsibility element as well. So it's very much a mix. And I guess we keep coming back to that, isn't it? It's one part of the puzzle that needs to be put together to make this work. And again, we keep saying it, but that evidence base on making sure it does work, that we understand the impact. But there's no doubt about it that there's work to be done there in terms of that 60% that could be recycled in those bins.
Yep. Does anyone else want to add anything on that before I move on? So it definitely is part of a puzzle. And of course, one of the advantages of a deposit return scheme is it helps to reduce contamination. So there's not just the challenge of the 60% who are recycling, and therefore the 40% of recyclable materials that are going into landfill rather than being recycled, but it's also about how we improve the quality of the recyclate that's going into recycling provisions as they are. So to me, the puzzle is deposit return. It's the considerations within this bill, but it's also about public awareness and cultural change. So regarding the provisions to put in the recycling code on a statutory footing, and to enable the setting of local targets, what evidence is there to suggest that taking a statutory approach in these areas will drive up standards, and what are the key opportunities in making systems more consistent across the country? So how do we drive up the standards and make the systems more consistent, and how important would these elements be?
I could just come back on that and then maybe move to others. I think there is an opportunity to explore some sort of charge potentially in relation to weight in terms of that residual waste on householders, but very much in the mix. I think there's something about the code of practice for local authorities which is really important, that there's a consistency of collection and process, and that there's an associated confidence in the system from those people who would need to, who are investing in all the processing and the recycling, and that's a really important element in this as well in terms of household waste.
Because local authorities will need to coordinate between themselves and establish best practice. I mean, think of an urban constituency like mine of Edinburgh, Northern and Leith, where there's general recycling, large street container bins, and all it takes is one person walking past to dump some contamination in there, sometimes unwittingly, and the whole recyclate is contaminated and therefore cast aside in some cases. So would you envisage, you know, significant engagement and strategic decision making from local authorities in order to make this work, and both in terms of making sure that the public are aware of their expectations before considerations of enforcement are applied, and then how is enforcement carried out and done in a just manner?
Yes, I think consistency of process around the country, consistency of message, consistency of approach is crucial here,
and consistency of practice and how it's implemented. Because any other feedback on that? Because I just want to come on to a last point that's already been raised by Mr. Gulland, which is about our facilities here for undertaking the requirements of this bill and the shared collective aim of reducing waste and increasing recycling. And what investment in waste, whether that's recycling, reuse, redistribution, infrastructure, will be needed to support the aims of the bill? I'd be grateful if you could elaborate on what you said earlier, because I think it's really important.
Yeah, I can just to go back to that. Yeah, I definitely think the kind of enforcement and the consistency approach add together. I think you're right. You need to do the consistency first. I mean, just that 60%. I mean, there's two elements to this, isn't there? The 60% of stuff that could be recycled in our current infrastructure that is in the residual bin. You know, so that's just an education. That's about awareness, and you know, keep giving that message across to people, because a lot of people will not be aware of that. So then that's before we get into the contamination challenge of people putting the stuff in the wrong bin, which simply people are putting it in the residual bin. But also getting that message across continually about the impact of that. Again, it's transparency. You know, a lot of people don't know where their recycler ends up. We're not sharing that information broadly across the whole of Scotland around what happens to that material, what it gets turned into, where it ends up, what's the end destination of that. And we've all seen the kind of horror stories in the media about, not specifically Scottish recycler, but UK recycler ending up in other parts of the world and being dumped. So does that niggle at the back of the consumer's mind that what is this? So we need to be much more transparent, and having much more obvious communications with the citizens will help, not just in the put it in the right bin, but let's recycle more. But in answer to the question, yeah, there's a whole list. I mean, there is a list. Name the material. There's an opportunity both at a kind of national level, but certainly at a local level. This is the circular economy. The thing we all forget is the circular economy is a distributive economy. It's not about sucking all the materials out into, with every respect, the central belt of Scotland, particularly with digital enablement and technology. We can size solutions into the rural parts of Scotland as well. But again, it does need coordination. For some of those things, whether it's mixed plastics, plastic film, electronics, all of those things need a coordination. With every respect, we're still, the supply chain, i.e. 32 local authorities, is still quite fragmented. They're all doing their own different way of collection. Again, that comes back to the consistency. So we had a consistent approach, we'd have the same materials being collected. But then how do we aggregate some of those materials, either at a national level or a regional level, to kind of make these solutions, maximise the opportunities? There's lots of interest. I mean, I was only down at an exhibition in Birmingham just a few weeks ago. There is lots of interest in a number of products, plastics, electronics, from a range of industries who are interested in coming to Scotland, because although we're a small country, we do have the scale of materials that potentially is available for inward investment. But it does need a bit of coordination, and it does need the signals around that consistency, that supply is going to be consistent across the country, and it's going to be of good quality, and it's going to start coming, into these economic opportunities. But it's also about reuse and repair. Shouldn't forget that. How do we create the right accessible infrastructure for those things to happen? And there's a role there for individual local authorities or local authorities working together to size some of those opportunities, both at a kind of really local level, but also within a kind of regional base, as we spoke to before about even if we were talking about reusing unused, unsold goods. So
the points about reuse, absolutely appreciate them. But just going back on. Pardon me?
The tool library.
Well, exactly, and several others. But just
where that suggestion came from, then, the convener.
Just going back to recycling, I mean, are you able to be any more definitive about what additional recycling infrastructure Scotland needs as a nation in order to meet the requirements of what's ahead and obtain a position where less of our recyclate is going offshore and elsewhere to be utilised?
Yeah, I'm happy to provide a list for the committee. Yes, there are a number of opportunities. Some of them are, like I say, at national level, for things like plastic bottles, for instance, PET, there's probably enough for one or two plants in Scotland. Some of them, different scale, could be more distributed around the country. There's a whole range, any material we could look at, And also there's an opportunity for landing something in Scotland that could potentially attract material from over the border, you know, from the northeast or the northwest of England, and to, you know, so having that ability to land one of those opportunities here in Scotland could have far-reaching dividend to the local economy, just as opposed to just looking after what's in the local area.
That follow-up would be appreciated.
But that needs economic opportunity. That economic parts of government as well to think about this. So it's not just about waste management. That gets into how can we harness the economic parts of government to see this as whether it's inward investment or job creation.
You could follow up on that, that'd be helpful. And your points about inward investment and job creation are absolutely of interest. And the fact that the consistency of a uniform position in terms of local authorities and the processing, the fact that that would attract inward investment is an interesting point.
I mean, of interest, I'm visiting Terry McDonald from America, from Oregon, from Eugene in Oregon. He's in Scotland this week. He's speaking at the Scottish Resources Conference in Perth tomorrow. So he runs social enterprise in Eugene. It's about 250,000 people in various reprocessing or reuse and remanufacturing opportunities in that area. It's a $60 million business based on resources in the local area and out with that into reusing, remanufacturing, repurposing materials. And all of that $60 million is deployed back into the community for emergency shelters, relief for people in poverty. So it's creating a massive dividend, and it's all based on resources. So that's just an example of what's possible for Scotland without thinking about big, you know, scale in terms of the national picture. That could be delivered at local levels across Scotland.
Thank you. Thanks.
A few other questions on household waste, but Monica wants to come in and ask a supplementary on a point that's been raised earlier, and then I'll come to Douglas. Monica.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, listening with interest, I just wanted to pick up on the theme of single-use items. Single-use nappies clearly contribute a lot of waste and end up in landfill. We know that some councils have initiatives locally and a small scale to improve access to reusable nappies. I just wondered if colleagues on the panel, I suppose best aimed at you, Ian, feel that there's more scope outside the legislation to do more of that locally and to have these schemes that can work with nappy libraries, for example. Or is there potential for this legislation to try and perhaps put more of a duty on local authorities and other partners to do this in a much more proactive way?
I mean, briefly on that.
Yes, there is more we can do. And obviously, there's a lot of initiatives at a local level. They need to be promoted more, they need to be more accessible, and it comes back to the point about what we call recycling opportunities, but reusing opportunities or, you know, addressing consumption opportunities, I guess, when you're thinking about reusable nappies. That infrastructure, that's what we need to start thinking about. How can we encourage that infrastructure, whether that's through legislation or powers or investment, but thinking about the broader health and well-being opportunities that these things... So this is not just about thinking about the environmental benefits, thinking about the broader societal benefits that these solutions will offer. And certainly, you know, there's conversation to be had with local authorities that this isn't circular economy bill. It's not just about bins and boxes. It's about how they can broaden out their thinking, thinking about their procurement operations, thinking about their community engagement, thinking about their health, you know, in terms of, preventative health and all that sort of stuff. This is a real opportunity. So absolutely, things like real nappies should be put into that mix.
Okay.
That's great. Thank you.
Thanks, Monica. I'm going to come to Douglas. You're next, I think.
Thank you, Convener. And it's just following on from the Deputy Convener's questions, really. You know, I think, David, it was yourself that mentioned, first of all, that 60% of things that could be recycled aren't yet being recycled. But to get that number, and I think we've been going the wrong way in terms of recycling as well. And I guess we don't need to wait for this legislation to come into place before we actually look at some of those things. So what things could we be doing now to try and improve our recycling rates?
I think we need more of the sort of initiatives that we spoke about in the last half hour or so. I think we do need a strengthened producer responsibility. Extended producer responsibility will make a big difference, because that's about reducing the amount of waste that's generated in the first place. I think that's a major part of it. I think some of the additional provisions here is part of it too. I do think that there's an element of a stick in terms of in terms of household waste and people potentially having to pay by weight for what gets disposed of. A deposit return scheme will help. It's all in the mix. I do think we need more at this point. We have plateaued with, I would say, education has a role to play and public awareness. And I think Nick mentioned that wider societal education about what we use. And just as an aside, I mean, even in terms of our use of water, we use more water domestically than just about any other country in Europe. In terms of, so there's something about our psyche in terms of our use of resources that I think across the board could be improved, and more education and awareness there. But I do think more action is needed to make that difference. It has plateaued, that overall recycling rate of 43%. So something else needs to be done.
And it's different in different areas, parts of Scotland as well. Probably Ian probably knows more about that.
It is, but it's not massive. I mean, overall, it's...
Yeah, it does vary.
I mean, 50s, is it?
Yeah, it does vary across different council areas, and some of that to do with urban, rural, or the housing type, and you know the particular challenges that some parts of Scotland has. But the consistency discussion and approach will surely help that, you know, because it will get into some of those conversations. How do we both simplify or make more consistent the approach to recycling, and that will then feed on to kind of more general messages. But obviously there is investment currently, you know, that the government is providing £70 million for improving recycling services as we speak. You know, we're obviously committed quite a bulk of that money already. But one of the challenges with that, with every respect, is it's capital. It's money that's going into infrastructure, but a very limited amount of money is going into communication, which ultimately, if you're introducing a new service, you obviously need to educate the people about what that new service is, but you need to continue that on an ongoing basis. And it comes back to even the 60% figure. You know, we know that that's just getting communication to people, because that's existing infrastructure that's already available. That's not anything new that needs to be developed. That's just whether that's paper or tins or plastic bottles that could go into the current system. So there's something about communication there. But I also think, you know, we do, you know, slightly, this probably goes into the question about targets. We beat ourselves up slightly, absolutely, in terms of the recycling rate. But again, we're measuring tons of material. You know, we've developed a carbon metric here in Scotland, which is about measuring the carbon intensity of our waste management operations, which will actually see that we have made significant changes in that, or we've reduced the carbon impact of our waste management system significantly over the last 10 to 15 years, and more importantly, in the last 5 years, when we've really focused on things like food and plastics, which are the big capital-intensive items. And obviously, you people who know, we released a report earlier this year about textiles. So where textiles in the household waste stream is only 4% by weight, but by carbon, it's 34%. So that's what we need to be doing. I mean, you know, going back to the climate emergency, we need to be tackling the issues of the products, the materials in our waste stream that are carbon-intensive. So that might not shift the recycling rate for Scotland, unfortunately, but we need to really do it, and we have been addressing that. We've been tackling food waste, we've been tackling plastics, and we want to tackle textile waste next.
I guess the problem is, though, there's still a lot of inconsistency across different parts of Scotland, especially on food waste, for example. Some local authorities will collect it, others won't. I guess that all has an impact on ends up in the general waste bin.
Yeah, so if there's a conversation here about how do we, if there are about targets, and saying these targets, these are carbon targets, and they're part of your target emissions reporting. So that's something the councils do take very seriously in terms of the reporting. So if we could make that link that this is just as much about carbon as it is about delivering a service and hitting recycling rates in terms of tonnes as part of your carbon, you might see a lot more councils looking at what's in their bin, what's in their waste stream, and how can they target that from a carbon point of view, and you'd start to see an increase in participation rates.
And Ian, you mentioned lack of facilities as well, probably in terms of plastic, for example. So I presume at this time
all our sort of PET stuff gets shipped to other parts of the UK or elsewhere, or so there's just been a lack of investment into that. But that's something that could be done now. Once again, it doesn't have to wait for a bill to come forward.
No, it doesn't. It could happen now. Yeah. It does need coordination, does need the right level of support for some of those companies to come into Scotland or for Scottish businesses to develop that infrastructure here in Scotland for that. But it does need, you know, I keep saying that, you know, we can talk about this and the one job and the eight jobs, but to get that economic opportunity, we need to design it. It won't happen by chance. You know, these are, to some extent, UK global commodities. But we want to see that success for Scotland. We all need to come round and not just think about the bins and boxes and think about the broader system and how can we create that here in Scotland. And we might not get it all, you know, but there are certainly big wins out there that we could... And like I say, there is a significant interest in some of these opportunities.
OK.
I'm just going to just make an observation. And I'm very carefully phrased this, but talking rubbish is very interesting, and we're getting through a pile of questions, but the problem is we're also getting through a pile of time. So I'm going to push members and panellists to give succinct answers to very succinct questions. And I'll come back to you, Douglas, then, if you've got one.
Last piece of question I had was, in terms of labelling, do you think there should be more done on that? You know, because there is some labelling just now, but it's... Once again, it depends where you are in the country, whether you can actually recycle certain things. And things like Pringles tubes is always one I used to get
absolutely.
In the past.
Yes.
Yes. And I think, just coming back to the circular economy strategy, this having a statutory footing is going to be really important for many of the questions that you posed there, because what the sector needs is the certainty that the country is serious about this and isn't going to change its mind. And I think that really helps with that sort of investment in all elements of the infrastructure and all, whether it's the processing and the ability, you know, the facilities nationally to do that, or even whether it's the labelling, it's just that commitment to this and having that in a statutory footing, I think will help with a lot of that. And then the consistency around the collection and process, again, it really helps with the labelling.
Thanks, Camino.
Thank you. Monica, I'm not sure, do you have a question on this subject?
I'm off mute. Yes, I am. No, I'm happy to. I was going to ask about fly tipping, so I can.
Okay. Just before we go to fly tipping, can I ask a very quick question on household waste and 32 authorities, 32 different schemes, different coloured bins, different sized bins? I get confused what I'm supposed to be putting in what bin when I go where. Certainly, we come to Edinburgh. I have no idea which bin replicates my. Well, I don't have recycling bins in my area because the council doesn't do recycling in the remote area I live in. So, but I would be confused if I was putting things in a green bin, a blue bin, a brown bin. I think yellow bins are now out. But should we have something simple across all of Scotland, which means that everyone could understand it? And should the council recycle some of their recycling bins to make them one colour so we know what we're talking about? Ian, do you want to go on that?
Yeah, I know that's a challenge. It comes up a lot. We wouldn't advocate, you know, taking all the bins away and then putting out a brand new set because that would, you know, use up two materials. So I think it is about communication. I think if there's a consistency of approach, I don't think it really matters what colour the bins are. I think there has been more innovative suggestions where, regardless of the colour of the bin, you just put a number on it. So it's, you know, if it's 1, 2, 3, if everybody's got 4 bins around Scotland or 6 bins or whatever, or 1 bin, then that's the number. So there's different ways of doing it. It comes back to the labelling. How can you link up the labelling, both at a national level and a local level, to the infrastructure that we've got? We're not able to do that because, you're right, we have 32 different systems. But that's what the consistency of approach is all about. So how can we do that and then use that as a basis to communicate and engage with citizens across Scotland, regardless of where they live? But recognising that it's not so much the geographical opportunities that could be different, but also housing types and trying to understand that. So it's a bit more sophisticated, but there's an opportunity for sure for providing a much more consistent and, you know, and I think it will be different for different areas, but that's about communication.
OK, Monica, fly tipping. I think you're on.
Yeah, I've hinted that I want to ask about fly tipping. Keen to hear from all the panel, so don't feel you have to answer all the questions, but
What impact in particular do you think the provisions in the bill will have on fly tipping? And is there anything else you'd like to see in the bill in that regard? And also keen to hear, outside of circular economy bill proposals, what else is happening to improve enforcement and prevention of fly tipping? So maybe start with David on that, but keen to hear from Nick and Ian if they have anything to add.
Yep. So I think one area that could be improved is that the requirement to remove materials isn't just on the landowner, and I think we could have that requirement on the fly. The fly tipper is going to be really helpful. I think there's something about the responsibility for all parts of the of that bad process to have accountability, so that if businesses or individuals have used an unauthorised, illegitimate business to then have it disposed in the countryside, I think having some sort of implication, potentially some sort of fine or punitive element to those businesses. So there's a duty of care from both in terms of individuals and the business. I think that'll be really helpful. I could leave it at that.
Yeah, no, that's helpful. What about Nick? Do you want to add to that, thinking about that impact on the environment and perhaps wildlife as well?
Nothing specific about what needs to be in the bill, but obviously just to highlight the impact of fly tipping on wildlife, and it can be locally quite damaging, and also these things are quite sort of cumulative, aren't they? If people see that there's fly tipping going on and it's acceptable, then they're less caring, or often less caring for their environment. So it's part of, I suppose, also empowering local communities to be able to see that that's not acceptable, and I don't want that damage on the quality of my environment, but also on the wildlife. And there's nothing more distressing than seeing, I don't know, a swan or a duck entangled in material that's been fly tipped. So that's all I would add.
Thank you.
OK, I think that, Monica, that neatly leads on to Jackie's questions. You've got some questions, I believe, Jackie.
Yes, I do. Thank you, Convener. You're reading my mind. It is to follow on from what Monica was saying about household waste. We all get... Oh, and I should probably declare my interest... Convener, as a former local councillor for Aberdeen City, because I'm away to ask a question regarding what enforcement challenges do SEPA and local authorities face in relation to waste crime as a whole. I know Ben touched on it earlier, but when we talk about fly tipping, people automatically think it's about households, and it's not all about households. It's also about businesses. And their fly tipping. So I'd like to ask the panel regarding that. And actually, adding on, do they think that the power to seize a vehicle who has been caught as part of fly tipping be a sufficient deterrent? I'm in your hands, Convener, because I can't see the panel about who'd like to answer that.
When you ask the question, Jackie, they all looked in the opposite direction. I don't think anyone... No, that's not true. David, I think you were nodding your head.
Yeah, in that particular provision, that we'd really welcome that. That's quite a powerful incentive, if that's the right word, that we would welcome. Yep, it's very helpful.
And Ian, do you want to add anything on that?
No.
Okay. Okay, you've got your answer. Have you more questions, Jackie?
Yes, and I'm taking that answer to be a yes, please, if I heard that correctly.
Yeah, two out of the three are nodding and one's looking away.
Yeah.
Oh, he's nodding now.
I would just like to ask David if SEPA have the resources and skills to make use of the new powers that is proposed in the bill.
So in terms of, there's a lot of development work when it comes to new ways of regulating. We talked about some of them earlier. There's a considerable amount of sort of preparatory work to implement something like that. system, application systems, the IT behind all of that does require investment, and we will be working with government to ensure that for whatever new powers and whatever new duties are required, that we will be funded appropriately for that implementation phase. However, once these things are up and running, as I said before, half of our income comes from charges, so we would then generate a charging scheme that would enable that cost recovery of that work from implementation onwards.
Okay, thank you. One last question, Convener, and I think I'll direct it to Ian if you don't mind, but anybody else can come in. It's just to ask what other work is being done to tackle waste crime, and do you think that the bill could be strengthened any further to support that work?
So I guess, as Zero Waste Scotland, we're not directly involved in that. Obviously, we work with partners, particularly SEPA, and in terms of the rural economy, thinking about, you know, behavioural change and aspects of that, and engagement with communities who are blighted by issues of fly tipping. But again, much broader, you know, a successful implementation of a circular economy, you would expect to close out those types of opportunity, because basically fly tipping, illegal as it is actually leakage out of the circular economy stuff. So if you create a much more circular system for the particular materials that are being fly tipped, so that would be the first point, you create a different framework for the security of those resources, which if we do it right, as I said, if we design this right, will actually limit the opportunity for criminals to be involved in that. At the moment, it's in the terms of the linear economy, it's, I'm not saying easy for them, but there are opportunities for them to make money out of that to some extent. So I would say the shift to circular economy, I'm not going to say it's going to end the criminality, but it's certainly a successful deployment at national level, particularly at local level, in terms of managing resources in a much more sustainable, economically and socially aware and transparent operation, will surely help us to make it harder for criminals to be involved, and also, you know, for householders possibly not to be persuaded to do the wrong thing, because they'll be much more integrated as citizens, individual citizens, into a system which is both locally based and nationally based and globally based for you know, all the reasons that we've talked about. So I like to think that's where we come, you know, because the, you know, there are opportunities around the, whether it's white goods, whether it's, you know, household waste, even some of the commercial waste that's dumped as well. There's real opportunities in the circular economy to close that loop, for a better word.
Right. Jackie, have you got further questions? The Deputy Convener wants to come in with a brief follow-up, and then I'm going to go to Douglas for a couple.
Thank you.
Ben.
Thank you, Convener. Just, I think, Mr. Glenn, those are really important points. I think about fly tipping in my constituency, most of it is sofas and mattresses, and some of that is criminal, and that people are bringing those resources, those materials, and dumping them in certain areas. But some of it is just people putting those out in the street because either they can't afford, or they are unaware, or they don't have the motivation to take it to an appropriate facility. So I think those are points well made. But I just wanted to come back to the issue of the challenge of organised crime within the waste management sector, and I just wondered if SEPA, you had anything to add, Mr. Harley, about that as a wider challenge. Again, as I said earlier, I appreciate the sensitivity, so if you'd prefer to follow up in writing, obviously that would be understandable, but I do think it's an important wider consideration.
Briefly, David.
Yeah, as I said, 10 years ago we set up a new unit to tackle this. It's really, really important work for us. We put a significant amount of resources with significant progress, taking bad actors out of the game. Prosecutions are in progress. We work very, very closely with the police, because some of this is associated with organised crime. It will continue to be, as we move forward in this more circular economy world, it's really important that you have strong enforcement around those unintended consequences, or those trying to take advantage of the system. So continues to be really important.
Thank you. Thank you. And Douglas, I'm going to allow you one question. I'm sorry, I'm going to be really mean.
That's okay. We've been hearing from businesses, and they've got real concerns about the burden of the reporting that they'll have to comply with once this legislation come into place. Do you have a view on the amount of reporting that sort of businesses are going to have to do post-legislation?
Not so much a view on the amount, but I do think as regulators and players in this, I think if we have the systems, which, you know, there's a lot of technology development and potentially AI that could help us with this. I do think if we have sophisticated systems, we could reduce that burden and also make it easier for the regulator, for ourselves, to understand where the flows are going in the right way and where potentially they're going in the wrong way in terms of that illegal activity. So I think the investment in good systems is going to be really important.
Mm-hmm. Ian?
Yeah, no, I do hear that a lot, but for an organisation, we work directly with a lot of businesses, and, you know, once they start to measure the waste and the resources and stuff like that, they then, you know, can take action, and we've got lots of evidence that we actually, businesses are saving money on the back of it. Yes, you know, implementing those systems, particularly around food waste, I know that's something that's mentioned specifically, you know, the businesses, yes, it takes some different challenges at the beginning, perhaps, for infrastructure or equipment, and even training, but actually over the piece they will make savings, and I think, you know, so there's the kind of longer picture here about how can they, you know, report internally and externally, and it comes back to that transparency in terms of them engaging with consumers, but also business to businesses in terms of supply chain. There's much more of that being asked by people in the supply chain. But also it comes back to the, for us in the circular economy, it comes back to the question about where are these opportunities for material reuse, repurposing, reprocessing. We need to understand that, you know, so having that information at a macro level, whether that's through sectors specifically, you know, to gauge where the materials are, where they're flowing, where can we access them and actually create some of those circular economy opportunities. But more importantly, if there are common themes or common waste streams within particular sectors or particular locations, how can we harness them for economic benefit? So that reporting element absolutely helps individual businesses. We can show evidence of that, but it also helps shape, it will accelerate to some extent the opportunities that we can have at a kind of more macro level, or certainly a sub-regional level.
I guess the concern is that there is no detail as yet, but that's fine.
If you are going to leave it there, that was quite a long answer, and I'm sorry, I'm really up against the clock. And I reiterate, there are some things that committee members want to ask today, which we've been unable to ask just because of the time restrictions. And there are some questions on targets and target settings, which I would like to, well, the clerks will follow up in writing to ask if you have views on it, because we should have got to them, but we haven't, due to my poor time management. But thank you very much, the three of you, for giving evidence today to the committee. I am briefly going to suspend the meeting for literally 2 minutes. I want you back here, committee members, at 12:10 to do the next part, but to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you very much. I'll suspend the meeting. Thank you and welcome back. Our next item of business is consideration of two Type 1 consent notifications for, firstly, the Persistent Organic Pollutants Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2023 and the Public Service Obligations in Transport Regulations 2023. These are two proposed UK statutory instruments where the UK Government is seeking the Scottish Government's consent to legislate in an area of devolved competence. We are notified of these on the 6th and 8th of September, respectively. It's the committee's role to decide whether it agrees with the Scottish Government's proposals to consent to the UK Government making these regulations within the devolved competence and the manner and in the manner that the UK Government has indicated to the Scottish Government. If members are content for consent to be given for the UK SIs, the committee will write to the Scottish Government accordingly. In writing to the Scottish Government on both UK SIs, we have the option to pose questions, highlight issues, or to ask to be kept up to date on the relevant developments. If the committee is not content with the proposals, it may make recommendations outlined in the clerk's notes for these instruments. Firstly, I'm going to ask members' views on the Persistent Organic Pollutants UK SI. Does anyone have any comments? Okay, there are no comments. So I now need to move to the substantive question on this item. Is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be made in the proposed UK statutory instrument? Are you content with it? You are. Okay, so we'll write to the Scottish Government to that effect. Now I would invite members to views on the public services obligation in Transport UK SI. Does any member have any comments on this? Mark, I see your hand is up.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. My only point on this regulation is that this committee has not had adequate notice, adequate time to consider this. So I don't object to what's being put forward here today at all, but I am concerned about that 28-day rule being continually broken, and I would just seek your guidance as to what we can do to urge governments to ensure that this committee is treated with respect and we've got enough time to consider anything that comes before us.
We can just, of course, write back and say that, which I think is a valid point. I would just draw your attention, Mark, to the fact that we were notified on the 8th of September regarding this instrument. It is just a function in some respects. I would have liked to have seen it come up earlier within the committee than the 3rd of October, but it is a function just of how busy we are. So I'm very delighted, and I think we should write back as a committee to say that we would like to be considered to get earlier notifications so we can consider this more fully. Is the committee agreed that we should write as part of our submission on this to make that point? I'm sort of looking at nods. So if we do that, I want to move to a substantive question, is that are you happy within the provision within the notification should be, sorry, are you happy that the provision set out in the notification should be made in the proposed UK statutory instrument? If the answer is yes, which it appears to be, then we will write to the Scottish Government to that effect, but we will include within that a request that we be given further time to examine these items. Move on to the next agenda item, which is the consideration of two negative instruments, the Parking Attendants Wearing of Uniforms North Ayrshire Council Regulations 2023 and the Road Traffic Permitted Parking Area and Special Parking Area North Ayrshire Council Designation Order. The instruments are laid under the negative procedure, which means their provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. No motions to annul have been lodged. Do members have any comments on either of these instruments? No. So, Can I invite the committee to agree that it doesn't want to make any recommendations in relation to these instruments? Are we agreed? We are agreed. That concludes, therefore, the public part of the meeting. And therefore, so we'll go into private session.